myths, lies, and corona wars. The truth about COVID-19, Bill Gates, and the plan to vaccinate the world. Our inalienable rights have completely evaporated within the space of a few months, based on deceptive science and shameful fear-mongering. This audiobook is comprised of a series of articles, reports, transcripts and book passages written by journalists, independent researchers, doctors and scientists from all over the world. I have provided additional commentary where needed, to help listeners follow the wide-ranging topics covered. There are four main parts to this audiobook. Part 1. A COVID State of Mind. An in-depth look at the event of COVID-19 and subsequent worldwide lockdown, fake death stats, Orwellian legislations implemented, and media propaganda. Part 2. A bunch of experts MSM will ignore. Numerous scientists and doctors offer a more realistic threat analysis, as well as a detailed assessment of lockdown theory and COVID-19 under the microscope. Part 3. Spidergate. The truth about Bill Gates's network of conflicting business interests, his dangerous vaccines and his vision for the world. We also take a closer look at Neil Ferguson, Fauci and the WHO. Part 4. Technocracy Risen. How Gates, Silicon Valley, and Big Finance are using COVID-19 to implement a technocratic world order. Due to the large number of sources used in the creation of this audiobook, and my desire to provide a succinct listening experience, the authors' names and links to their website have been included in the written post description indicated by the relevant time markers. The goal of this project is to provide an in-depth resource for further research as the events of COVID-19 unfolds. No profit has been made from this production, but if you find this audiobook insightful, please consider supporting the various contributors referenced in the post description as they provide a vital service that is heavily under attack. This audiobook would not exist without them. It's highly likely that this audiobook will be removed from mainstream social media due to the nature of the content provided. I would therefore request all listeners take the following actions. 1. Share this audiobook with everyone who has ears to listen. 2. Download this file via the link in the description and upload to your video sharing site of preference. They can censor one, but they can't censor all. Important note. Everything mentioned in this audiobook is simply the opinions of the various authors included, and there are many people who violently disagree with their conclusions. The author presents this information for educational purposes only. Before you listen to this book, please check with your friends, politicians, priest, rabbi, psychic, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Fauci and especially Bill Gates to ask for permission to listen to the information being presented. Most important of all, remember to clap for care enthusiastically at the allotted time from the confines of your home. Welcome to the Corona World Disorder. Audioboy279.com. Truth, audiobooks for the people. Part 1. A COVID State of Mind. The Mainstream Matrix. For those of us who've woken up to the fact that everything we see in the mainstream media is designed to condition us to accept what we are being told without question, it can sometimes be difficult to understand how billions of people around the world have been reduced to docile, fearful sheeple waiting for an authority figure to give them their version of reality. But given the fact that many of our friends, family and indeed the vast majority of society are still very much being groomed to welcome their own enslavement, it's important to understand what they're actually being subject to in order to help free their minds. It's also important to remember that many of the people who promote this narrative are victims of their own propaganda and will fight tooth and claw to defend it. What follows is an excerpt from Vox of the single narrative fear-mongering that is absolutely rife across all mainstream media. It reads: The legacy of the pandemic. 11 ways it will change the way we live. Very few aspects of life are untouched by coronavirus and resulting global lockdowns. From an emerging quarantine state of mind to a new era of frugality to expanding how we vote, here's what's next. COVID-19 has moved like wildfire, at first seemingly far away, then unnervingly close, as it has ripped across the world in a few months, leaving tens of thousands dead, economies flattened, and the futures of hundreds of millions of people in limbo. As many of us shelter in place with no end in sight, it's only human for us to imagine how life will resume, even if the unfamiliar and unpredictable behavior of the virus has made it difficult to know with any certainty. The longer the global effort to stymie the pandemic through lockdown continues, the less likely we'll re-emerge into a world we recognize. Healthcare, stretched to horrifying extremes in afflicted cities, must change, and it will. The world's Instagram-fueled love affair with travel will cool. Many will keep stashes of personal protective equipment at the ready, many more will lose faith in governments to assist us, much less protect us. To begin to envision the legacy of this COVID-19, Vox asked experts in fields ranging from behavioral sciences to economics, restaurateurs, and big thinkers on democracy and public health to predict what's next. These, they say, are 11 ways the pandemic will transform our societies. A quarantine state of mind will reign for weeks, if not months. For many, the doldrums of quarantine are now giving way to post-isolation fantasies, as people pledge to spend more time with family and friends, or finally book that bucket list trip. But even the smallest and sweetest of goals, getting a haircut, giving a hug, or grabbing a drink, could feel like climbing Mount Kilimanjaro when we're free. We're going to have to work through this quarantine state of mind even when the physical quarantine has lifted, says Shiva Rajari, founder of the Center for Anxiety and OCD in Irvine, California. The coronavirus has made intimacy feel treacherous, because the disease can sometimes move from person to person through the most mundane activities, like talking, kissing, even singing. That it can be transmitted asymptomatically has forced us to envision everyone as a potential threat. We are training people to see the world as a dangerous place. This invisible enemy could be anywhere, says David Spiegel, a professor of psychiatry and behavioral sciences at Stanford University. Interacting with your barber or bartender won't be easy if you view them as potential carriers. There will be a lot of damage to be undone as people try and rebuild some semblance of a normal life, Spiegel says, adding that avoidance makes phobias worse. Exposure will be an important part of recovery. The temporary solution to the coronavirus, self-quarantine, and potentially months of it, not only delays this process, but also has psychological repercussions of its own. The true extent of the problem is not yet clear, and there are few analogues. But in Wuhan, China, where the virus originated, some people there now refuse to leave their homes and have developed agoraphobia, psychiatrist Stephen Taylor told The Atlantic. FOMO has morphed into FOGO, or the fear of going out. Some people's reticence to re-engage with society may resolve on its own, Rajari says, but for many, this is the beginning of a lifetime of management. Eleanor Cummins. Cummins reports on the intersection of science and popular culture. She previously wrote about social distancing scofflaws for The Highlight. The mask will become a wardrobe staple. In the United States, masks are more readily associated with crime than public health. We're a nation of mask skeptics. Several states have enacted anti-mask laws throughout history as a means of quelling protest and stifling dissent. But the immediacy of the pandemic, the horror stories of bodies stacked up in refrigerated trucks, the overwhelmed hospitals, and the atmosphere of fear and paranoia created in its wake, will force Westerners to reconsider old stigmas associated with masks for the sake of public health. The mask aversion is compounded by the long-standing epidemic of police violence against people of color, some of whom understandably fear the consequences of purchasing essential goods while cloaked in a prophylactic bandana. Even now, it's easy for a mask to evoke dastardly connotations or be mistaken for a disguise. Wearing a mask may be even stranger to us than wearing a Speedo at the beach, says Brandon Brown, an epidemiologist and associate professor at UC Riverside. It's just not the norm in the US, so there is judgment, but there is nothing wrong with it. In China and other nations, masks are now part of everyday life. Abra Chutai, an epidemiologist and researcher at the University of New South Wales in Sydney, Australia, says via email. Asian countries have faced such epidemics and pandemics more in the past, he says, including SARS outbreak of 2002-2004, which still looms large in the public imagination in China and Hong Kong. These nations have long understood face coverings as a public health resource and a tool for cultivating national unity. It's routine, for example, to see people donning masks on the streets of Beijing, Seoul, or Taipei as they take to the streets or socialize with friends, because someone with a cough will likely be hesitant to put their neighbors in jeopardy. It does seem that in general, thinking of and protecting others is more of a norm in some countries other than our own, Brown says. But public sentiment on the issue of masks is evolving. Just as the US mobilizes to provide frontline workers with personal protective equipment amid mass shortages, brands are also swooping in to meet a surge in demand for masks that gel with modern consumer tastes. Cloth masks designed and marketed by Los Angeles Apparel and Christian Siriano are reflections of this broader shift in the cultural climate. Mega influencers like Kim Kardashian and Bella Hadid have also endorsed them with pandemic-era selfies, lending masks a stamp of pop culture-approved normalcy. Though the science behind the effectiveness of masks is far from exact, living through the pandemic will undeniably alter Western attitudes about them, as well as government policy. And as the memory of COVID-19 becomes permanently enmeshed with the national psyche, masks are likely to become a fixture of our post-pandemic world. Sam Blum. Blum is a writer and journalist based in New York. We all realize that the American economic system is fundamentally broken. The US has tied health insurance to employment and then shuttered broad swaths of the economy to respond to a health crisis, during which millions of workers have been laid off, leaving them without health coverage. Our social safety net is in disrepair and overwhelmed when people need it most. Many of our essential workers are making the minimum wage. People of color are dying of the coronavirus at disproportionate rates. The economic and social framework of America was already tenuous, and the pandemic has broken it. We built an economy that is a very fine-tuned race car that can go very fast, and might occasionally win a few races, says Roosevelt Institute President Felicia Wong, but once it breaks down, it's very difficult to fix, and there really is no underlying resilience. Wong believes we're at a crucial choice point, in which we either repair the system with a band-aid that still leaves us fragile or move toward a government with more guardrails for the economy and a bigger role in setting the direction of our health, social insurance, and economic systems. Many Americans have long believed in a pull-yourself-up-by-your-bootstraps ideology, the American dream, that if you work hard enough, you can make it. It's a country where the is the people who made it, and the them, often with a racial element, are people who are viewed as lazy and inept. But rugged individualism and the free market can't fix many of our current problems, and, in fact, have rendered the country increasingly vulnerable and fragile for years. Amid the current devastation, will we begin to imagine the role of the federal government in our society and our economy as one that takes a more hands-on, proactive approach? There's a chance, though we will need leaders to drive us there, many of whom are being radicalized right now. After moments of crises, the US government and its people historically have tended to want to go back to the way things were before, and it's unclear that this time will be different, warns Jamila Michener, an assistant professor of government at Cornell University. But we also can't unsee what we've seen. The proximate problem is the virus, Michener says, but the deeper problem is the structure of our social, political, and economic systems. Yet change isn't always easy to perceive. The Occupy Wall Street movement, born out of the Great Recession, was broadly deemed a failure, but it has animated much of the leftist politics and policies of the past decade. America is broken, but it can be fixed. Emily Stewart covers business and politics for Vox. Voting will become easier, and turnout might go up. The images of Wisconsin's recent election, the first in-person election held during the height of the COVID-19 US outbreak, were dystopian. In Milwaukee, where the number of available polling places shrank from 180 to just 5 for a city of about 592,000 people, voters wearing surgical masks stood 6 feet apart in lines stretching around the block. One woman held up a large homemade sign emblazoned with the words, "This is ridiculous." Wisconsin is a messy dress rehearsal for what will happen in November if we don't act, ACLU voting rights campaign strategist Molly McGrath recently told Vox. The pandemic has temporarily upended U.S. elections as some states push back their primaries to early June. But this time is giving lawmakers an opportunity to reimagine what our election system could look like. While electronic voting is still a faraway goal, given concerns about the possibility of hacking, ideas are already circulating for how states could get paper ballots into the hands of more voters and increase turnout. In the 5 states that already have universal vote by mail, studies have found voter turnout increases, particularly among those less likely to vote in person. Exercising one's constitutional right to vote could be as easy as checking a box, sealing an envelope, and putting it in the mail. Even if it is a process that might slow down vote counting, in the Senate, the effort is being led by Ron Wyden and Amy Klobuchar, who introduced a bill in the wake of coronavirus that would expand both in-person early voting and no-excuse absentee vote by mail. It would require states to set up contingency plans in the event we are still social distancing by the November general election. The bill would open up in-person polls 20 days before Election Day in each state to give people the opportunity to vote early, require all mail-in ballots submitted in the 21 days leading up to an election be counted, and make it so all voters can request an absentee ballot. In Switzerland, for example, all voters receive mail-in ballots that they can submit up to 3 weeks before the election, and in New Zealand, advance voting polls are set up 12 days before Election Day. There's increased agreement among Democratic and Republican governors and secretaries of states that something must be done to coronavirus-proof their elections. New Hampshire's Republican Governor Chris Sununu recently announced that the state could expand absentee voting if the virus persists into the fall, a measure he has previously opposed, and Republican officials in other states may do the same. But getting all states ready will take time and a lot of federal money. And President Donald Trump and some congressional Republicans are balking at expanding vote-by-mail access, even though there's no evidence it favors Democrats, and some Republican states have long used it. The pandemic, and Wisconsin's election in the midst of it, could be a watershed moment to make the case for vote-by-mail reform. Ella Nilsson. Nilsson covers Congress and Democrats for Vox. Free money might someday be bound for your bank account. Universal basic income is the idea that the government should give every citizen a regular infusion of free money, no strings attached. It's moved from the fringes into the mainstream over the past few years, with several countries around the world running pilot programs to test it. Now, the coronavirus and its economic ripple effects are bolstering the view that such payments are necessary, during the pandemic, and even after it. Spain has announced it will roll out a basic income as soon as possible to help its citizens cope. Crucially, Deputy Prime Minister Nadia Calviño said the government aims to make this something that stays forever, that becomes a structural instrument, a permanent instrument. In the UK, more than 170 members of parliament have also urged the government to give citizens a UBI during the pandemic, though so far their calls have been rejected. Scott Santons, a prominent UBI advocate, said he believes the pandemic will make a UBI in the US more likely as well. Through no fault of their own, people are finding themselves in need of money, he told Vox. This profound feeling of insecurity may be quite new to people who felt they had job security, and they may gain an appreciation for permanent economic security through an income floor that would always be there, just in case. Political figures such as Democratic Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and former presidential candidate Andrew Yang also say the US should follow suit. People who may even have symptoms are going to work in public places because they don't feel they have a choice, Yang told CNBC. A universal basic income would enable these waitresses and parking attendants and ride-hail drivers to stay home. Although some Americans are getting a one-time $1,200 coronavirus stimulus payment, those are not a true UBI, they're an emergency stopgap measure rather than a permanent program. UBI gives people income stability so they can do long-term planning, which in turn can make them happier and healthier. Many people are now encountering the inadequacy of the American safety net for the first time. They're finding it deeply frustrating to have to make dozens or even hundreds of attempts to file benefits claims while unemployment offices are overwhelmed by demand. It could be simpler and more humanizing for money to simply show up in their bank accounts. As people get more frustrated with bureaucracy and conditions, Santon said, I think they will start thinking differently about a system that operates differently, one built on trust and dignity instead of distrust and degradation. Sigil Samuel. Samuel is a writer for Vox's Future Perfect. Say goodbye to handshakes, and casual hugs and kisses. The shock of COVID-19 has already caused people to rethink norms as simple as shaking hand. As we try better to protect ourselves and our loved ones during this, and future, pandemics, we will create new taboos around personal hygiene and behaviors. Terms such as personal protective equipment have already entered common parlance, a phenomenon that could be extended to personal protective behaviors, call it PPB. Actions such as never coughing or sneezing into the open air or onto one's hands, and avoiding touching one's eyes, nose, or mouth. People will wash their hands and avoid touching public objects much more, and greetings that do not involve hand-to-hand contact will be popular. Historically, certain behaviors become taboo for what on the surface are religious or cultural reasons, but probably originate from an understanding of their health risks. Cultures that don't eat pork, for example, likely stopped because in warm climates the meat often carried dangerous parasites such as trichinella worms. Now, Dr. Anthony Fauci, director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases and the top U.S. expert on the virus, has supported the idea that we should never shake hands again, and seeing people in films hugging, shaking hands, and kissing is already causing a frisson. In the post-COVID-19 world, the strengthening of taboos is inevitable. A cross-cultural shift will leave people less keen to engage in physical ways to show politeness or affection. Susan Michie and Robert West. Michie and West are professors of health psychology at University College London. Religions will embrace their online future. Recently, just off Interstate 40 in a western part of North Carolina, a clergy member and 10 funeral guests stood several feet apart from one another around a casket as it was lowered. As the cars drove by, the mourners dispersed, heading back to their own places of isolation, unable to hug each other as the intimate, albeit distant, service concluded. When history looks back on this moment, one thing will be clear for religious and spiritual leaders: gathering together matters most. Though many will bemoan the live streaming efforts, the lack of in-person worship, or the fruition of online giving, in the midst of the worst of the pandemic, and after, many religious leaders will claim virtual community building as a means of survival and growth. Many pastors are grappling with the complexity of encouraging older church members to use online services and giving. Urban and suburban churches that minister to homeless populations are struggling to find those members if they don't have a physical address. Some might say these issues have always been there. While that may be true, the isolation and distancing, and the desire for spiritual guidance right now, makes these realities all the more complex. As one pastor of a United Methodist Church in Los Angeles said, "The pandemic crystallizes our mission. We have to focus on what's most essential for our respective communities. It also provides a clearer vision of a leaner but kinder church, one capable of bending toward change." The recognition of love and truth telling in a community setting should have been the mission of the church a long time ago, and for some clergy and congregations, it has been. But the takeaway is clear: people are in need of community, and though they can't gather like they wish, they still wish to gather. Perhaps soon those mourners in North Carolina can give their loved one the send-off they deserved. Until the moments of gathering return, communities of faith will continue forward into the unfolding future creatively, but only if they accept and embrace the possibility the innovation of this moment holds. Reverend Rob Lee. Lee is a pastor of Unifor Church, a diverse community of faith in North Carolina. And there you have it. A glimpse of the future for the masses of sheeple who will no doubt be gulping down this factually deficient handy-dandy fear porn propaganda that even Edward Bernays would be proud of. COVID-1984. The new normal. We do have some say in all this. In a televised CBS interview with Anthony Mason on April 2, Bill Gates issued a few key words that have since become iconic in the world of mainstream media. As has been the general trend whenever the famed co-founder of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation declares something that appears to implicate the personal lives of every other person on the planet. These words effectively set the tone for what would become an oft-repeated stanza across the globe. Gates advised that life is not expected to get back to normal until a thorough, international vaccination infrastructure has been implemented. On Fox News Sunday, April 5, Bill Gates specifically told host Chris Wallace that life won't get back to normal until a vaccine is delivered to the entire world. Within days of these rather bold prescriptions from the Microsoft founder, news headlines around the world were lit ablaze with the parroted advice that life as we know it, is not expected to return to normal until a vaccine is available. Quoting directly from Canadian Prime Minister Trudeau during his nationwide address on April 8. Normality as it was before will not come back full on until we get a vaccine for this. Similarly, European Commission President Ursula von der Leyen warned the public that life cannot be expected to resume any sense of former stability until a vaccine becomes widely available. While she was initially setting an optimistic, if you can call it that, timeline of the fall of 2020, her predictions were cooled by the European Medicines Agency, which suggested a more conservative arena of 12 to 18 months. In the meantime, news media everywhere are essentially saying the same thing: life as we know it is not expected to return to normal until a vaccine program is in some kind of deliverable form for the entire world. Gates himself offered 18 months as a reasonable time frame, and, in the interim, his recommendations are fairly transparent. As he explicitly stated during his CBS interview, "The country's leaders need to be clear: shutdown anywhere means shutdown everywhere." While these words were specifically addressed to the US, it is no mystery that the intentional audience here is humanity in general. At any rate, the narrative has been set. As news headlines everywhere have told us, things are expected to be upside down until we are vaccinated on a nearly worldwide scale. In the meantime, society en masse has now been successfully programmed to quietly sit still and wait out the ensuing lockdown so that, eventually, our collective discomfort from a bleeding economy and progressive intimacy starvation leads us to such a state of prolonged desperation where we're more than happy to bear our arms, and our children's arms, to the awaiting syringe. By that time, we will have also been more than sufficiently indoctrinated in the so-called dangers of COVID-19, where we will be ready and ripened for the solution to everything that has fragmented our society since Wuhan first became a household name. In a sobering article recently published in MIT Technology Review, Gideon Litchfield discusses his views of why social life on a global scale may never return to us in quite the same way at all. He warns that as long as someone in the world has the virus, breakouts can and will keep recurring without stringent controls to contain them. Litchfield then proceeds to outline some rather cold possibilities of what typical life may come to look like in the future, including cell phone location data for tracking unwitting risk offenders. He reports that this would not be for tracking merely the infected themselves, but ultimately for people who've been in touch with known carriers of the virus. In other words, we're talking government policies of keeping tabs on pretty much everybody through constant smartphone monitoring. He also asserts that we'll restore the ability to socialize safely by developing more sophisticated ways to identify who is a disease risk and who isn't, and discriminating legally against those who are. He suggests that possible methods may include universal screening of body temperature fluctuations, specific family size, and even annual income. While noting the very likely risk of creating even more social inequities, Litchfield's concluding comments are simply that the onus will be on government officials to reflect on the propensity for increased social dysfunction, and to work hard to guard against the exacerbation of it. In the meantime, however, Litchfield makes a repeated point that the public, in response, will somehow learn to adapt to these changes and essentially move forward with whatever form life happens to take in the aftermath of these things. He writes that we'll adapt to such measures, much as we've adapted to increasingly stringent airport security screenings in the wake of terrorist attacks. Furthermore, the intrusive surveillance will be considered a small price to pay for the basic freedom to be with other people. With these considerations in mind, he correctly points out that the true cost will be borne by the poorest and weakest. MIT Technology Review, March 17, 2020. Predictions such as these, in my mind, do not border in any way in the realm of science fiction. In my opinion, Litchfield's views appear to have a rather passive flair, particularly when it comes to the issue of widespread public acceptance of such Orwellian approaches to social management. His repetition of terms like acceptance and adaptation in the context of public response lend to an overall theme of involuntary submission, the picture of a society that essentially has no choice in the governance of their affairs and even their very personal lives. But I suspect that content such as that covered in MIT Technology Review, while accurate on many counts, is nevertheless in the business of building one very specific thing, consumer adaptation to ideals and standards established by high-level and corporate interests. Let us be clear. The majority of information that has been given to the international public has been fed and filtered through a severely one-sided source. It is also no secret that the vast majority of our mainstream media is owned by a literal handful of agencies who have much to gain by steering public perception. This oligopoly consists primarily of AT&T, Comcast, the Walt Disney Company, Viacom CBC, and the Fox Corporation. Together, these and their subsidiary agencies are indeed very wise in their aims to cash in on the official story of the coronavirus pandemic, primarily since stories of fear tend to sell products of distraction. Let me simply point out the fact that any self-respecting global citizen owes it to themselves to look beyond the confines of the evening news, as well as seeing beyond the unquestioning mass obedience that has taken over our cities, and spend some time to at least review the rest of the information that experts, scientists, and independent news producers are trying to share, that is, as long as the self-righteous techno-oligarchs haven't removed them from their hosting platforms yet. The point is that our history has patiently demonstrated to us time and time again, that society has often hindered itself by blindly adhering to the official narrative that some person in power have fed to the overall population. As Marshall McLuhan put it so succinctly, all media exist to invest our lives with artificial perceptions and arbitrary values. More appropriately, the issue of collective values is where I want to dedicate the rest of my thoughts here. Because, as we have experienced up until this point, it seems to me that we have allowed our shared values to become largely shaped by something most of us don't even really understand properly. All of a sudden, it seems, we have found ourselves abiding by a set of social norms which, despite how bizarre they must appear to an outside observer, are nevertheless the root of much shaming and mutual policing, principally because there have been enough corporately paid talking heads and ill-informed leaders who are telling us that social distancing is the responsible and safe thing to do. Ridiculous public behavior aside, my graver concern lies in the fact that our worldwide public culture now appears to have been sufficiently neutered and primed for the next stage of this whole illegitimate process. Specifically speaking, how many of us are actually going to resist the call to be vaccinated once it becomes publicly available? Will the social pressure have evolved to such an established norm where resistance will result in serious ostracizing and rejection from our familiar locales and community hubs? Will we be deemed unsafe and irresponsible for simply trying to preserve our personal morals of health and safety, in addition to those of our children? Because let's face it, if we're already heckling people for stepping within our 6 feet of personal space, then how will we treat those who are deemed guilty for questioning and resisting the very antidote to the thing that is widely regarded as the very source of our problems to begin with? My urge is that we remind ourselves of the fact that a collective human response to any manufactured phenomenon begins with the single individual. I dare say we will not find opportunity to resist vaccination or any other illegitimately imposed custom if we are silently waiting for others among us to step out of line first. The fact is that our societies have, to a large extent, already been lined up outside the pharmacy. Global leadership and popular media have made sure of that. That pharmacy is soon to be opened up, and the longer we wait in line, then the harder it will be to actually step out of it. Granted, I don't know exactly what the rollout of such a vaccine in this instance will look like. I don't think many of us do really. In all reality, it may look simply like a mandatory thing for people working in certain sectors and with specific populations. Alternatively, it will be widely promoted as the only reasonable thing to do, and most will simply go along with it since too many people, at least up until now, have not bothered to ask the bigger questions about it. With that in mind, I advise that we openly question the narrative that life as we know it will not return to normal until we're all vaccinated. After all, we're the ones buying into that idea, and our complicit acceptance of it is what necessarily gives it force. We breathe life into this type of propaganda, purely through our obedience to it and by failing to question the impulses and agendas that have gone into its design. Let me take a final moment to clarify that I'm not proposing that what we previously enjoyed as our baseline normal is really the ideal either. Far from it. Pre-COVID normal is not the gold standard in my opinion, nor do I imagine that it's everybody else's. It was simply all we knew as a society. In fact, one thing that our universal lockdown has served, in a positive sense, is to hopefully stimulate us on a deep personal level to the point of re-evaluating the things in life that matter most. Granted, some of us have resorted to binging on streaming media and mainstream news gospel, as Viacom would no doubt have intended in the first place. So rather than launching our vision purely from a place of nostalgia for a perceived era of comfort and familiarity, my intention here is simply to underscore our critical importance as the ultimate deciders of our public fate. It really comes down to what we are willing to go along with, and as far as I'm concerned, apathy is the most dangerous thing facing our future. At the risk of sounding like an alarmist, the choices we make in the dawn of a questionable vaccine will go a long way in determining our continued evolution as a society. And while I am not here to criticize one's personal choice for vaccination, I am nevertheless insisting that one have the right to that very prized principle itself. Choice. By blindly adhering to the official prescription for mass conduct in the meantime, we are letting powerful agencies know precisely which buttons need to be pushed in order to get our species moving and behaving in the most desirable way. Lockdown and shut up. Locking in the new global order. On the 12th of March, British PM Boris Johnson informed the public that families would continue to lose loved ones before their time as the coronavirus outbreak worsens. He added, "We've all got to be clear, this is the worst public health crisis for a generation." In a report, the Imperial College had warned of modelling that suggested over 500,000 would die from the virus in the UK. The lead author of the report, epidemiologist Neil Ferguson, has since revised the estimate downward to a maximum of 20,000 if current lockdown measures work. Johnson seems to have based his statement on Ferguson's original figures. Before addressing the belief that a lockdown will help the UK, it might be useful to turn to an ongoing public health crisis that receives scant media and government attention, because context is everything and responses that are proportionate to crises are important. The silent public health crisis. In a new 29-page open letter to Fiona Godley, editor-in-chief of the British Medical Journal, environmentalist Dr. Rosemary Mason spends 11 pages documenting the spiralling rates of disease that she says, supported by numerous research studies cited, are largely the result of exposure to health-damaging agrochemicals, not least the world's most widely used weed killer, glyphosate. The amount of glyphosate-based herbicide sprayed by UK farmers on crops has gone from 226,762 kg in 1990 to 2,240,408 kg in 2016, a tenfold increase. Mason discusses links between multiple pesticide residues, including glyphosate, in food and steady increases in the number of cancers both in the UK and worldwide, as well as allergic diseases, chronic kidney disease, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, obesity and many other conditions. Mason is at pains to stress that agrochemicals are a major contributory factor, or actual cause, for the spikes in these diseases and conditions. She says this is the real public health crisis affecting the UK and the US. Each year, she argues, there are steady increases in the numbers of new cancers in the UK and increases in deaths from the same cancers, with no treatments making any difference to the numbers. Of course, it would be unwise to lay all the blame at the door of the agrochemical sector. We are subjected each day to a cocktail of toxic chemicals via household goods, food processing practices and food additives and environmental pollution. Yet there seems to be a serious lack of action to interfere with corporate practices and profits on the part of public bodies, so much so that a report by the Corporate Europe Observatory said in 2014 that the then outgoing European Commission had become a willing servant of a corporate agenda. In a 2017 report, Hilal Elver, UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food, and UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights and Hazardous Substances and Wastes Basgut Tunkak were severely critical of the global corporations that manufacture pesticides, accusing them of the systematic denial of harms, aggressive, unethical marketing tactics, and heavy lobbying of governments which has obstructed reforms and paralyzed global pesticide restrictions. The authors said that pesticides have catastrophic impacts on the environment, human health and society as a whole, including an estimated 200,000 deaths a year from acute poisoning. They concluded that it is time to create a global process to transition towards safer and healthier food and agricultural production. At the time, Elva said that, in order to tackle this issue, the power of the corporations must be addressed. While there is currently much talk of the coronavirus placing immense strain on the NHS, Mason highlights that the health service is already creaking and that due to weakened immune systems brought about by the contaminated food we eat, any new virus could spell disaster for public health. But do we see a lockdown on the activities of the global agrochemical conglomerates? Not at all. As Mason has highlighted in her numerous reports, we see governments and public health bodies working hand in glove with the agrochemicals and pharmaceuticals manufacturers to ensure business as usual. So, it might seem strange to many that the UK government is seemingly going out of its way by stripping people of their freedoms under the guise of a public health crisis, but is all too willing to oversee a massive, ongoing one caused by the chemical pollution of our bodies. Mason's emphasis on an ongoing public health crisis brought about by poisoned crops and food is but part of a wider story. And it must be stated that it is a silent crisis because the mainstream media and various official reports in the UK have consistently ignored or downplayed the role of pesticides in fueling this situation. Systemic immersion. Another part of the health crisis story involves ongoing austerity measures. The current Conservative administration in the UK is carrying out policies that it says will protect the general population and older people in particular. This is in stark contrast to its record over the previous decade, which demonstrates contempt for the most vulnerable in society. In 2019, a leading UN poverty expert compared Conservative welfare policies to the creation of 19th-century workhouses and warned that unless austerity is ended, the UK's poorest people face lives that are solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Philip Alston, the UN reporter on extreme poverty, accused ministers of being in a state of denial about the impact of policies. He accused them of the systematic immiseration of a significant part of the British population. In another 2019 report, it was claimed that more than 130,000 deaths in the UK since 2012 could have been prevented if improvements in public health policy had not stalled as a direct result of austerity cuts. Over the past 10 years in the UK, there has been rising food poverty and increasing reliance on food banks, while the five richest families are now worth more than the poorest 20% and about a third of Britain's population lives in poverty. Almost 18 million cannot afford adequate housing conditions, 12 million are too poor to engage in common social activities, 1 in 3 cannot afford to heat their homes adequately in winter, and 4 million children and adults are not properly fed. Britain's population is estimated at 63 to 64 million. Welfare cuts have pushed hundreds of thousands below the poverty line since 2012, including more than 300,000 children. In the wake of a lockdown, we can only speculate about how a devastated economy might be exploited to further this austerity agenda. with bailouts being promised to companies and many workers receiving public money to see them through the current crisis, this will need to be clawed back from somewhere. Will that be the excuse for defunding the NHS and handing it over to private healthcare companies with health insurance firms in tow? Are we to see a further deepening of the austerity agenda, let alone an extension of the surveillance state given the current lockdown measures which may not be fully rolled back? The need for the current lockdown and the eradication of our freedoms has been questioned by some, not least Lord J. Sumption, former Supreme Court Justice. He has questioned the legitimacy of Boris Johnson's press conference statement to deprive people of their liberty and has said, "There is a difference between law and official instructions. It is the difference between a democracy and a police state." Journalist Peter Hitchens says a newspaper headline for Lord Sumption says the headline might be, "Former Supreme Court Justice says Johnson measures lead towards police state." Or, "Top judge warns of police state." But, as Hitchens implies, such headlines do not appear. Indeed, where is the questioning in the mainstream media or among politicians about any of this? To date, there have been a few isolated voices, with Hitchens himself being one. In his recent articles, Hitchens has questioned the need for the stripping of the public's rights and freedoms under the pretext of a perceived coronavirus pandemic. He has referred to esteemed scientists who question the need for an efficacy of social distancing and keeping the public under virtual house arrest. An open letter from Dr. Suchrit Bhakdi, Emeritus Professor of Medical Microbiology at the Johannes Gutenberg University Mainz, to Angela Merkel calls for an urgent reassessment of Germany's lockdown response to COVID-19. Then there is Dr. Ioannidis, a professor of medicine and professor of epidemiology and population health at Stanford University. He argues that we have made such decisions on the basis of unreliable data. These two scientists are not alone. On the Off Guardian website, three articles have appeared which present the views of 30 experts who question policies and/or the data that is being cited about the coronavirus. We'll address this later on. Shift in balance of power. Professor Michel Chosudovsky has looked at who could ultimately benefit from current events and concludes that certain pharmaceutical companies could be, or already, major beneficiaries as they receive lavish funding to develop vaccines. He asks whether we can trust the main actors behind what could amount to a multi-billion-dollar global compulsory vaccination surveillance project. The issue of increased government surveillance has also been prominent in various analyses of the ongoing situation, not least in pushing the world further towards cashless societies, under the pretext that cash passes on viruses, whereby our every transaction is digitally monitored and a person's virtual money could be declared null and void if a government so decides. Many discussions have implicated the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in this, an entity that for some time has been promoting the rollout of global vaccine programs and a global war on cash. For instance, financial journalist Norbert Herring notes that the Gates Foundation and U.S. state financial interests had an early pivotal role in pushing for the 2016 demonetization policy with the aim of pushing India further towards a cashless society. However, the policy caused immense damage to the economy and the lives and livelihoods of hundreds of millions in India who rely on cash in their everyday activities. But that does not matter to those who roll out such policies. What matters is securing control over global payments and the ability to monitor and block them. Control food, you control people. Control digital payments, and remove cash, you can control and monitor everything a country and its citizens do and pay for. India has now also implemented a lockdown on its population and tens of millions of migrant workers have been returning to their villages. If there is a risk of coronavirus infection, masses of people congregating in close proximity then returning to the countryside does not bode well. Indeed, the impact of lockdowns and social isolation could have more harm than the effects of the coronavirus itself in terms of hunger, depression, suicides and the overall deterioration of the health of older people who are having operations delayed and who are stuck indoors with little social interaction or physical movement. If current events show us anything, it is that fear is a powerful weapon for securing hegemony. Any government can manipulate fear about certain things while conveniently ignoring real dangers that a population faces. In a recent article, author and researcher Robert J. Burrows says, "If we were seriously concerned about our world, the gravest and longest-standing health crisis on the planet is the one that starves to death 100,000 people each day. No panic about that, of course. And no action either. And, of course, each day we live with the very real danger of dying a horrific death because of the thousands of nuclear missiles that hang over our heads. But this is not up for discussion. The media and politicians say nothing. Fear perception can be deliberately managed, while Walter Lippmann's concept of the bewildered herd cowers on cue and demands the government to further strip its rights under the guise of safety. Does the discussion thus far mean that those who question the mainstream narrative surrounding the coronavirus are in denial of potential dangers and deaths that have been attributed to the virus? Not at all. But perspective and proportionate responses are everything, and healthy debate should still take place, especially when our fundamental freedoms are at stake. Unfortunately, many of those who would ordinarily question power and authority have meekly fallen into line, those in the UK who would not usually accept anything at face value that Boris Johnson or his ministers say, are now all too easily willing to accept the data and the government narrative. This is perplexing, as both the government and the mainstream media have serious trust deficits, putting it mildly. If we look at the false narratives in numerous areas, including chemical attacks in Syria, Russian aggression, baseless smear campaigns directed at Jeremy Corbyn and WMDs in Iraq. What will emerge from current events is anyone's guess. Some authors, like economist and geopolitical analyst Peter Koenig, have presented disturbing scenarios for a future authoritarian world order under the control of powerful state corporate partners. Whatever the eventual outcome, financial institutions, pharmaceuticals companies and large corporations will capitalize on current events to extend their profits, control and influence. Major corporations are already in line for massive bailouts despite them having kept workers' wages low and lining the pockets of top executives and shareholders by spending zero-interest money on stock buybacks. And World Bank Group President David Malpass has stated that poorer countries will be helped to get back on their feet, on the condition that further neoliberal reforms and the undermining of public services are implemented and become further embedded. Countries will need to implement structural reforms to help shorten the time to recovery and create confidence that the recovery can be strong. For those countries that have excessive regulations, subsidies, licensing regimes, trade protection or litigiousness as obstacles, we will work with them to foster markets, choice and faster growth prospects during the recovery. In the face of economic crisis and stagnation at home, this seems like an ideal opportunity for Western capital to further open up and loot economies abroad. In effect, the coronavirus provides cover for the further entrenchment of dependency and dispossession. Global conglomerates will be able to hollow out the remnants of nation-state sovereignty, while ordinary people's rights and ability to organize and challenge the corporate hijack of economies and livelihoods will be undermined by the intensified, globalized system of surveillance that beckons. Coronavirus lockdown, and what you are not being told. We have been given a very clear narrative about the declared coronavirus pandemic. The UK state has passed legislation, in the form of the Coronavirus Act, to compel people to self-isolate and practice social distancing in order to delay the spread of SARS-CoV-2, SC2. We are told this lockdown, a common prison term, is essential. We are also told that SC2 has been clearly identified to be the virus which causes the COVID-19 syndrome. At the time of writing, SC2 is said to have infected 60,733 people, with 7,097 people supposedly dying of COVID-19 in the UK. This case fatality ratio of 11.7% is seemingly one of the worst in the world. Furthermore, with just 135 people recovered, the recovery rate in the UK is inexplicably low. Some reading this may balk at use of words like seemingly and alleged in reference to these statistics. The mainstream media have been leading the charge to cast anyone who questions the state's coronavirus narrative as putting lives at risk. The claim being that questioning what we are told by the state, its officials and the MSM undermines the lockdown. The lockdown is, we are told, essential to save lives. It is possible both to support the precautionary principle and question the lockdown. Questioning the scientific and statistical evidence base, supposedly justifying the complete removal of our civil liberties, does not mean those doing so care nothing for their fellow citizens. On the contrary, many of us are extremely concerned about the impact of the lockdown on everyone. It is desperately sad to see people blindly support their own house arrest while attacking anyone who questions the necessity for it. The knee-jerk reaction, assuming any questioning of the lockdown demonstrates a cavalier, uncaring disregard, is puerile. Grown adults shouldn't simply believe everything they are told like mindless idiots. Critical thinking and asking questions is never bad under any circumstances whatsoever. Only the state, with the unwavering support of its MSM propaganda operation, enforces unanimity of thought. If a system cannot withstand questioning, it suggests it is built upon shaky foundations and probably not worth maintaining. Yet perhaps it is what we are not told that is more telling. among the many things we are not told is how many lives the lockdown will ruin and end prematurely. Are these lives irrelevant? We are not told the evidence for the existence of a virus called SARS-CoV-2 is highly questionable and the tests for it unreliable. We are not told that the numbers of deaths reportedly caused by COVID-19 is statistically vague, seemingly deliberately so. We are not told that these deaths are well within the normal range of excess winter mortality, and we are not told that in previous years excess winter deaths have been higher than they are now. We didn't need to destroy the economy in response to those, far worse, periods of loss, so why do we need to do so for this? Understanding mainstream media disinformation. Before we address what we are not being told, it's worth looking at how the MSM is spreading disinformation. On February 22, one rag printed a story which absurdly alleged, without a shred of evidence, that Russia was somehow deliberately spreading disinformation about coronavirus. It reported this uncritically, questioning nothing. Their opening paragraph read, "Thousands of Russian-linked social media accounts have launched a coordinated effort to spread misinformation and alarm about coronavirus, disrupting global efforts to fight the epidemic," US officials have said. On March 10, the same rag reported another story about disinformation in which it was noted, "Disinformation experts say, there remains little evidence of concerted efforts to spread falsehoods about the virus, suggesting that the misleading information in circulation is spread primarily through grassroots chatter." The irony shouldn't be overlooked. Directly contradicting their own previous disinformation, this MSM pulp assumes we are all so stupid we won't notice the perpetual spin and evidence-free claims. The United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights spells out what freedom of expression means. All human beings are born free with equal dignity and rights. All are afforded these rights without any distinction at all. Article 19 states, "Everyone has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. This right includes freedom to hold opinions without interference and to seek, receive and impart information and ideas through any media and regardless of frontiers." The MSM is responsible for the majority of misinformation and disinformation circulating at the moment. We must diligently verify every claim they make and check the evidence ourselves. They are not to be trusted. As the BBC quite rightly points out, stop before you share. Check your sources. If it's the MSM, check to see if they offer any evidence at all or if it's just their opinion. If it's their opinion, ignore it. It's almost certainly unfounded. Pause if you feel emotional. If you do feel emotional, you have probably just been manipulated by the MSM. Science LED means cherry-picking science. The UK state has been keen to insist that we all believe their lockdown response is led by the science. However, they have cherry-picked the science to roll out the lockdown and ignored the considerable scientific evidence which contradicts it. Both the UK and US governments used the computer models of Imperial College London, predicting millions of deaths, to justify the removal of our civil liberties. Almost as soon as the lockdown was in place, the scientists, having launched their vaccine research fundraiser, downgraded the projections from an estimated 550,000 deaths in the UK to 20,000 or even lower. Neil Ferguson, the lead scientist responsible for the initial ICL report, stated that they had revised the figures because of the effectiveness of the lockdown safety measures, claiming the lockdown would need to last for at least 18 months until a vaccine is found. ICL are grant recipients of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They have shown no interest at all in researching possible preventative treatments, reducing the need for a vaccine, such as hydroxychloroquine. The initial ICL computer models were based upon unproven assumptions. They assumed that SC2 would spread like influenza. This was contrary to the findings of the World Health Organization, who stated both that SC2 did not appear to spread as quickly as influenza and was less virulent. The World Health Organization found up to a 20% infection rate, where people were exposed to SC2 in crowded settings for prolonged periods, and a 1-5% infection rate in the community. This was nothing like the spread of the 1918 H1N1 influenza pandemic. However, publishing the paper on March 16, the ICL completely ignored the World Health Organization research, which was published a month earlier and stated, without any justification whatsoever, "COVID-19, a virus with comparable lethality to H1N1 influenza in 1918. Public Health England disagreed with ICL's evidence-free assumptions and downgraded COVID-19 from a high-consequence infectious disease, due to relatively low mortality rates. However, ignoring both the World Health Organization and Public Health England, the UK and US decided only the ICL knew what they were talking about. Cherry-picking their highly dubious research, they insisted the lockdown was necessary to flatten the curve and, in the UK, protect the NHS. The science the state has chosen to believe is the minority view, it seems. Epidemiologists, epidemiological statisticians, microbiologists, mathematicians and many other scientists and academics the world over have repeatedly warned that the lockdown is precisely the wrong thing to do. COVID-19, the disease supposedly caused by SC2, is experienced as little more than a bad cough or cold by the vast majority of relatively healthy people. Dr. Knut M. Witkowski, PhD, is among the growing number of globally renowned scientists who question what we are told by the state and its MSM. In regard to both SC2 and COVID-19, Dr. Witkowski stated, "With all respiratory diseases, the only thing that stops the disease is herd immunity. About 80% of the people need to have had contact with the virus. It's very important to keep the schools open and kids mingling to spread the virus to get herd immunity as fast as possible, and then the elderly people, who should be separated, and the nursing homes should be closed during that time, can come back and meet their children and grandchildren after about 4 weeks when the virus has been exterminated. If we had herd immunity now, there couldn't be a second wave in autumn." Such scientists and academics are all completely ignored by the state. Yet they believe others, such as Professor Neil Ferguson and Professor Corinne Lacombe, without hesitation. Perhaps it is just a coincidence that the scientists the state chooses to believe overwhelmingly appear to have close links to the globalist foundations and pharmaceutical corporations developing the vaunted coronavirus vaccine. Are you sure about the coronavirus lockdown? Those who reject all criticism of the lockdown, and simply accept whatever the state tells them, presumably believe the state only has our best interests at heart and would never do anything to harm us. Perhaps they believe that to question the claims of the state can only ever be conspiracy theory. Certainly that's the message constantly reinforced by the MSM. However, there is also plenty of evidence that the state frequently deceives the public. We only need look to the WMD lies told to start an illegal Iraq war in 2003 to understand that the state is willing to further the interests of the powerful and cares little about lives lost in the effort. Therefore, in the UK, it is worth recapping what it is we are consenting to with the Coronavirus Act. We consent to increased state surveillance of ourselves and our family. We are happy that we could be detained, without charge, because some state official suspects, or claims they suspect, we may be infected. It is fine with us that we or our loved ones can be sectioned under the Mental Health Act on the recommendation of a single doctor, and neither we nor they need to have the protection of a second opinion before we are locked up. We accept that the state can retain our biometric data and fingerprints for an extended period. We consent that jury trials are a bit of an anachronism and judges can hear more evidence by video or even audio link. We think it's fine that the evidence required, and processes undertaken, to determine and record our or our loved ones' deaths can be eroded to the point where they can be registered by people with no medical or legal expertise at all. We don't think the NHS needs to adhere to practice standards or bother with assessing the needs of some patients, especially older people. We are also fine with the complete suspension of democracy in Britain. We accept all of this based upon a unique subset of scientific opinion which, contrary to every known scientific principle, can never be questioned. We agree with the MSM that people who question any aspect of the stories they tell us are dangerous because these people just don't care if their own loved ones die. Only true believers care about their families. We also accept the need for the state to invest considerable resources creating counter-disinformation units whose purpose is to censor anything and everything which questions our firmly held beliefs. The beliefs informed by the many of the same people doing the censoring. I don't know about you, but I remain unconvinced by the evidence I've seen so far. I have no doubt that there is a health crisis and excess seasonal deaths, but I have seen no evidence at all that the numbers are unprecedented or unusual in any way. I accept that we should exercise the precautionary principle and take steps to limit the risks to the most vulnerable, but I do not accept that the lockdown is the best way to go about it. Nor do I see any necessity at all for all the other dictatorial clauses in the Coronavirus Act. I do not consent. If you think this will all be over soon and won't get worse, I'm afraid you may be disappointed. The UK state have based this lockdown on the scientific rubbish spewed out by ICL. Here's another one of the ICL's recommendations. The major challenge of suppression is that this type of intensive intervention package, or something equivalently effective at reducing transmission, will need to be maintained until a vaccine becomes available, potentially 18 months or more. There is nothing to suggest this isn't the intention of the state. Certainly voices in the US are already indicating their desire for an 18-month lockdown. Apparently taking their cue directly from the discredited ICL report and steadfastly ignoring everything else. Nor should we assume the draconian powers seized by the state won't get worse. Most of this response is being driven by globalist policy emanating, on this occasion, from the World Health Organization. Speaking at the daily World Health Organization press briefing on the March 30th, Dr. Michael Ryan, executive director of the World Health Organization Health Emergencies Program, said, "Lockdowns and shutdowns really should just be part of an overall comprehensive strategy. Most of the transmission that's actually happening in many countries now is happening in the household at family level. Now we need to go and look in families to find those people who may be sick and remove them and isolate them in a safe and dignified manner. Given that we now live in a de facto dictatorship, there's no reason to believe that states across the globe won't use this as justification to start removing people from their homes. My hope is that sense will prevail and, as it becomes clear the pandemic is waning, public pressure will mount to repeal this dictatorial legislation. However, given some of the comments I have seen on social media over the last 2 weeks, the panic buying and attacks upon anyone questioning the state's narrative, it seems many people are so frightened they desperately need to believe the state is trying to save them. This fear is based upon apparent ignorance of the economic severity of the lockdown and the monumental health risk it poses. People don't seem to want to know there is considerable doubt the Coronavirus Act is even legal in international law. There is also doubt that SARS-CoV-2 is an identifiable virus and the statistics we are given may well be based upon tests that can't identify it anyway. There is evidence that the statistics we have been given have been deliberately manipulated to exaggerate the health risk and there is no evidence these excess deaths are unprecedented. Effectively, a small group of policy decision makers have placed an estimated 3.5 billion people under house arrest. It is only possible for them to do so with our consent. Consent is carefully cultivated by controlling the information we are given. For the vast majority, their only source of information is the corporate mainstream media, MSM, and the public announcements of the state. We are going to look at the evidence which strongly suggests the state and the MSM, adhering to a globalist agenda, have colluded to mislead the public into believing the COVID-19 threat is far greater than it actually is. COVID-19 can be fatal for those with pre-existing comorbidities, and possibly even some without, as can other forms of pneumonia and influenza-like respiratory illness. However, while every COVID-19 death has been reported, none of the far greater numbers of people who have died in the UK this year from other respiratory infections have even been mentioned. Systems have been created to ensure the COVID-19 statistics are as terrifying as possible. The statistical product is so vague it borders upon meaningless. It seems we have been inculcated with misplaced fear to justify the lockdown regime, to convince us to accept it and prepare us for what is to come. Lockdown advised by WHO. The World Health Organization, WHO, is financed through a combination of assessed and voluntary contributions. Assessed contributions are paid by nation-states for WHO membership and figures are released quarterly. Voluntary contributions are additional contributions from member states and other partners. For some reason, these figures haven't been reported for more than 3 years. About 80% of the WHO's finances come from voluntary contributions. In its most recent 2017 voluntary contribution report, the WHO accounted for the $2.1 billion it received from private foundations and global corporations. This compared to just over $1 billion voluntarily provided by governments. Contributors included GlaxoSmithKline, Bayer AG, Sanofi, Merck and Gilead Sciences, whose drug Remdesivir is currently being trialed, alongside the off-patent hydroxychloroquine, as a possible preventative treatment for COVID-19. The Remdesivir trial is part of the WHO's Solidarity Trials. The third largest single contributor in 2017 was Gavi. Formerly called the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization, they contributed nearly $134 million. Gavi are partnered with the WHO, UNICEF, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the World Bank to sell vaccines globally. The World Bank contributed nearly $146 million themselves and the largest individual payment, by some margin, at nearly $325 million came from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Though like many other foundations and corporations, through their various networks of interlinked partnerships, their overall contribution was much higher. Among other beneficiaries of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation's generosity are the Vaccine Impact Modeling Consortium led by Professor Neil Ferguson. They are based at Imperial College London and are directly funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and Gavi. Their objective is to provide statistical data analysis for the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and Gavi in order for them to sell more vaccines. Professor Ferguson not only led the team who created the hopelessly inaccurate prediction which the US and UK governments based their lockdown regimes upon, he also co-founded the MRC Center for Outbreak Analysis and Modeling, who worked with the WHO in 2009 to create ridiculous computer models predicting the H1N1 pandemic. In 2009, the world went crazy after the WHO declared the H1N1 influenza pandemic. This resulted in billions being spent on very expensive H1N1 vaccines and antiviral treatments, although it turned out the pandemic was indistinguishable from seasonal flu. The only people who benefited from pointless vaccines and unnecessary medication were the manufacturers GlaxoSmithKline, Roche and Novartis. Each of these pharmaceutical corporations were among the largest voluntary contributors to the WHO in 2008-2009 financial year. With an $84 million investment, the Swiss pharmaceutical giant Roche were the largest single contributor into the WHO's coffers that year. Luckily, as it turned out, they could afford it because sales of their unnecessary Tamiflu H1N1 medication rocketed to more than £3 billion following the WHO's declared H1N1 pandemic. Which was just a coincidence. The whole debacle resulted in the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe launching an investigation into the WHO to look into the issue of a falsified pandemic. During the subsequent hearing, the epidemiologist Dr. Wolfgang Wodarg said, "The WHO basically held the trigger for the pandemic preparedness plans. They had a key role to play in deciding on the pandemic. Around $18 billion was spent on this pandemic worldwide. Millions were vaccinated for no good reason. It is not even clear that the vaccine had a positive effect, because it was not clinically tested." At the same hearing, Professor Dr. Ulrich Keil, director of the WHO Collaborating Center for Epidemiology at the University of Munster, said, "A number of scientists and others are questioning the decision of the WHO to declare an international pandemic. The H1N1 virus is not a new virus, but has been known to us for decades. In Germany, about 10,000 deaths are attributed to seasonal flu, especially among older and frail people. Only a very small number of deaths, namely 187, can be attributed to the H1N1 virus in Germany, and many of those are dubious. Of course, nothing came of it because PACE were making allegations against the World Health Organization. The WHO don't break the rules, they make the rules. Amazingly, probably because no one ever learns anything from history, we all believed the WHO this time. To imagine these huge investments made by pharmaceutical corporations and private foundations don't buy influence is so naive it barely warrants mention. The WHO is essentially a policy lobby group for the powerful globalists who own it. Why an organization with such significant and clear conflicts of financial interest should be considered a global health authority is anyone's guess." On the 11th of March, the WHO declared the SARS-CoV-2 global pandemic. On the 15th of March 2020, UK Health Secretary Matt Hancock stated that vulnerable people would be required to quarantine themselves or self-isolate. The state issued a set of guidelines for avoiding the spread of infection. On the 16th of March, UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson issued a statement advising people to practice social distancing, avoid non-essential travel, and warned that drastic measures may be needed to protect the NHS and the most vulnerable. On the 18th of March, the Director General of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation funded WHO Dr. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus gave a virtual press conference. He stated, "The World Health Organization continues to call on all countries to implement a comprehensive approach with the aim of slowing down transmission and flattening the curve. This approach is saving lives and buying time for the development of vaccines and treatments. As you know, the first vaccine trial has begun. This virus is presenting us with an unprecedented threat. We are about to discuss why COVID-19 is not an unprecedented threat." On the 20th of March, Boris Johnson ordered the closure of all venues for social gathering, such as pubs, cafes and restaurants. On March 23rd, the UK state legislated for the Coronavirus Act and placed the UK in lockdown. Just as the WHO and their other partners called on them to do. Lockdown to protect the NHS. The NHS was created to protect us, that's why we pay for it. It is difficult to pinpoint exactly when this relationship flipped on its head. After years of chronic underfunding by successive governments of all persuasions, interminable mismanagement, savage ideologically driven austerity cuts, crippling private finance initiative debts and increasing privatization for corporate profit, there is absolutely no reason to believe the state cares about either our health or the NHS. Every single major health policy and legislative decision, made over the last few decades, clearly demonstrates that it doesn't. The basic premise, apparently believed by so many, that the state has now decided to act to keep us safe is tragically comical. For us to swallow this tripe, we need to be sufficiently terrified to willingly accept the imagined protection of the state. The MSM has been doing its best to make sure we are and that we do. The 24-hour fear porn cycle is a wonder to behold. Most of this is based upon claims about deaths and stories about desperately overloaded hospitals struggling to cope with the pressure. Meanwhile, as millions of British people remain under house arrest, glued to their TVs and fondle pads, the data that has been released by official sources doesn't back up any of the tales we have been spun. This inconvenient truth has been reported by very few in the MSM print media and has been met with deafening silence on our TVs. Rather, the data has been convincingly spun to tell a story that doesn't stand up to scrutiny. Evidence of NHS overload is entirely absent. The state will claim this is thanks to the lockdown regime. Certainly, the fact that people with other serious conditions haven't been treated has alleviated pressure on the NHS. Unfortunately, the evidence also indicates the lockdown regime is probably killing them in increasing numbers. Though it seems unlikely, the state will claim responsibility for that. The Financial Times reported that close to half of the UK's hospital beds were empty. With just 60% of acute beds occupied, this is 30% less than this time last year. In the same period last year, the NHS was creaking under the pressure of demand, prompting then Prime Minister Theresa May to suggest scrapping NHS targets. Once again, the state was only concerned with how the figures looked, not about people dying on trolleys in corridors. This year it cares, honest. During a supposed global pandemic, we've had the lowest ever national A&E attendance. Manchester hospitals report a 57% bed occupation rate compared to their average of 94%. Most concerning is the huge drop in cardiology patients. With heart disease killing more than 40,000 people under the age of 75 every year in the UK, and with a reported rise in fatalities last year, this prompted Professor John Howarth from North Cumbria Integrated Care NHS Foundation Trust to express grave concern. "I am really worried that people are not seeking the help they need for important conditions other than COVID-19. Indeed, if your worldview is supplied by the MSM, deaths from anything other than COVID-19 seem to have become practically irrelevant in the space of a few weeks." The Health Service Journal reports that the NHS has four times as many empty beds as normal, confirming that more than 40% of acute beds are unoccupied. Even in London, the alleged epicenter of the COVID-19 pandemic, that figure is still nearly 29%. The much-publicised Nightingale Temporary Hospitals, a mobilisation the MSM were keen to portray as putting the nation on a war footing, which were allegedly required to cope with the surge of COVID-19 patients, aren't necessary. Of the 1,555 intensive care unit beds available in London, 1,245 are occupied. So questions must be asked: why 19 patients, who presumably needed intensive care, were seemingly moved unnecessarily into the 4,000-bed London Nightingale over the Easter weekend. Contrary to the claimed justification for the lockdown, as many have repeatedly warned, the health consequences of the lockdown regime could far outweigh the risks presented by COVID-19. Excess mortality this year is higher than average, but reported coronavirus deaths form a smaller part of that bigger picture. The HSJ reported a senior NHS sources who stated, "There could be some very serious unintended consequences. While there will be a lot of COVID-19 fatalities, we could end up losing more years of life because of fatalities relating to non-COVID-19 health complications." The Deputy Director of Research at the Nuffield Trust, Sarah Scobie, echoed this concern. "Public Health England data suggests there could be significant problems already developing for heart disease-related conditions patients, for example. Attendances relating to myocardial infarction at emergency departments have dropped right down, whereas ambulance calls in relation to chest pain have gone right up. Not only is there no evidence that the NHS is even close to struggling to cope with a non-existent surge, the likely severe health consequences of the state's lockdown policy are starting to emerge. When we look at the data on claimed COVID-19 deaths, the picture only becomes more alarming. lockdown and reported deaths. Every day, for weeks, the MSM has reported every single UK death which was supposedly due to COVID-19. This has been central to their effort to convince us of the severity of the pandemic. The reporting always supports the state's narrative that the lockdown is necessary. Under normal circumstances, when someone dies, a person who knows them well, such as a family member, or someone who was physically close to the person at the time of death, is the qualified informant who can notify the registrar of the circumstances and non-medical details of the death. That is not true for suspected COVID-19 patients. For them, a funeral director, who has almost certainly never met the deceased, can be the qualified informant. This places far more emphasis on the medical certificate of cause of death, as registration can take place without any input from family or anyone else familiar with the circumstances of the death. Prior to the Coronavirus Act, the last attending doctor to the deceased had the responsibility to register the death. However, in the case of suspected COVID-19 deaths, that duty can be discharged by a doctor who has never met the patient. The UK state guidance for COVID-19 patients states: a doctor who attended the deceased during their last illness has a legal responsibility to complete a MCCD. This duty may be discharged through another doctor who may complete an MCCD in an emergency period. In an emergency period, any doctor can complete the MCCD. For the purposes of the emergency period, the attendance may be in person, via video, visual consultation, but not audio, e.g. via telephone. Where the certifying doctor has not seen the deceased before death, they should delete the words "last seen alive by me" on. When an MCCD is completed, the medical causes are listed sequentially with the immediate cause of death at the top and the underlying cause of death at the bottom of the list. For example, heart failure caused by pneumonia stemming from influenza would list the immediate cause of death as a heart attack and the underlying cause as influenza. That underlying cause is usually diagnosed through positive test results. It is crucial to understand that for COVID-19 to be recorded on the MCCD as the underlying cause of death, there does not need to be any test-based diagnosis of the syndrome. Diagnosis can simply be from observation of symptoms or CT scans. The guidance to medical practitioners states: if before death the patient had symptoms typical of COVID-19 infection, but the test result has not been received, it would be satisfactory to give COVID-19 as the cause of death, tick box B, and then share the test result when it becomes available. In the circumstances of there being no swab, it is satisfactory to apply clinical judgment. Given this seeming lack of clarity, guidance from the Royal College of Pathologists RCP is also concerning. In circumstances where COVID-19 is merely believed to be a factor, they advise that there is no need for a post-mortem. If a death is believed to be due to confirmed COVID-19 infection, there is unlikely to be any need for a post-mortem examination to be conducted, and the medical certificate of cause of death should be issued. Post-mortems are not standard procedure and are normally required only where the cause of death is unknown or where the circumstances appear suspicious. However, the recommendation of the RCP is another part of a systemic approach to COVID-19 deaths which is inexplicably opaque. Even when a sample test is undertaken to identify COVID-19, questions remain. The RT-PCR test commonly used to test for COVID-19 does not appear to be very reliable, nor is it designed as a diagnostic tool for identifying viruses. A study from the Department of Microbiology, Queen Mary Hospital, University of Hong Kong found wild variations in RT-PCR accuracy. It was found to be between 22% to 80% reliable depending on how it was applied. This general unreliability has been confirmed by other studies. Further studies show clear discrepancies between RT-PCR test results and clinical indication from CT scans. Most of these studies indicate RT-PCR failure to detect COVID-19 in symptomatic patients, so-called false negative tests. When Chinese researchers from the Department of Epidemiology and Biostatistics School of Public Health conducted data analysis of the RT-PCR tests of asymptomatic patients, they also found an 80% false positive rate. Having passed peer review and publication, the paper was subsequently withdrawn for what seemed quite bizarre reasons. It was removed from the scientific literature because it depended on theoretical deduction. The paper was not testing an experimental hypothesis, it was an epidemiological analysis of the available statistical data. All such statistical analysis relies upon theoretical deduction. The claimed reason for withdrawal suggests that all data analysis is now considered to be completely useless. it seems scientific claims that COVID-19 numbers are underestimated are fine, claims they are overestimated are not. Either way, whether false negative or false positive, there is plenty of evidence to question the reliability of the RT-PCR test for diagnosing COVID-19. The MSM has suggested that enhanced RT-PCR testing can detect the virus SARS-CoV-2 and, in particular, the amount of it in the patient's system, the viral load. This is disinformation. The Nobel-winning scientist who devised PCR, Carrie Mullis, speaking about the use of PCR to detect HIV, stated, "Quantitative PCR is an oxymoron. PCR is intended to identify substances qualitatively, but by its very nature is unsuited for estimating numbers, the viral load. These tests cannot detect free, infectious viruses at all. The tests can detect genetic sequences of viruses, but not viruses themselves. Reported COVID-19 deaths can be registered without a test clearly diagnosing any coronavirus, let alone COVID-19. The death can be signed off by a doctor who has never seen the patient and can then be registered by someone who has never met the deceased and was nowhere near them when they died. Further provision in the Coronavirus Act then allows for the body to be cremated, potentially against the family's wishes, ensuring a confirmatory autopsy is impossible, though it is unlikely one will be conducted anyway. To say this raises questions about the official reported statistics is an understatement. Questions in no way allege either medical malpractice or negligence. Neither are required for significant confusion to occur because the potential for widespread misreporting of causes of death seems to be a core element of the COVID-19 MCCD process the state has constructed. Lockdown the data. At the time of writing, the UK is said to have 93,873 cases with 12,107 deaths attributed to COVID-19. Both the infection and mortality rates are showing a declining trend. Given the apparent haphazard reliability of tests, strange reporting procedures and oddly relaxed registration requirements, the claimed attribution is pretty weak. Coupled with the data which shows unusually low hospital admissions, with little to no evidence of the widely anticipated surge, justification for the state's lockdown of society and the economy appears painfully thin. The evidence base does not improve when we look at the official data. The Office of National Statistics have released analysis of the COVID-19 deaths that occurred during March 2020. In total, 3,912 deaths were recorded, of which 3,372, 86%, listed COVID-19 as the underlying cause of death. Of these, 38.1% were cases where COVID-19 was only suspected as the underlying cause, meaning neither a test nor any clear clinical presentation was observed. The problem is that the RT-PCR test, supposedly confirming COVID-19, doesn't tell us much either. Of the 3,372 deaths recorded with underlying COVID-19, approximately 3,068 had at least one comorbidity, with the majority having more than two. Not only does the RT-PCR test fail to provide any reliable proof that these people even had COVID-19, the existence of other comorbidities provides further reason to question if the COVID-19 was a contributory factor. Of the 3,912 people who died, 540 of them merely mentioned COVID-19 on the MCCG with no indication that it contributed to the deaths. With at least 91% of patients having comorbidities, there is very little evidence that the people who died with a COVID-19 infection wouldn't have died without. The age profile of the deceased is practically identical to standard all-cause mortality in the UK. If COVID-19 is a viral pandemic, it is one that behaves like normal mortality. And yet, despite all this, the MSM reported every one of them to the public as confirmed COVID-19 deaths. Another, perhaps even more alarming possibility has arisen. While heart disease accounts for 14% of COVID-19 comorbidities, reported deaths from heart disease have mysteriously dropped by the corresponding amount during the same period. This clearly indicates that patients dying from other causes, such as heart failure, are being recorded, and certainly reported by the MSM, as dying from COVID-19. This illustrates a far more complex picture than we have been given to believe. Why have the state and the MSM made so many alarming claims about people dying from COVID-19 when the evidence supporting those claims is, at best, questionable? None of this is the fault of medical practitioners or bodies like the Office of National Statistics. The ONS system has been both reliable and informative for many years. Yet once again, in the case of COVID-19 deaths, the state felt it was necessary to make some changes. On the March 30th, the MSM reported that the UK state had instructed the ONS to change the way they record COVID-19 deaths. Explaining the change to recording mentions of COVID-19, an unnamed spokesperson for the ONS said, "It will be based on mentions of COVID-19 on death certificates. It will include suspected cases of COVID-19 where someone has not been tested positive for COVID-19. This habit of states deciding to change the COVID-19 mortality data by adding in people who are assumed to have died from it appears to be a global policy. The China CDC did the same, and the US have just added a significant number to the statistics. In every case, the revision increases and never decreases the fatality statistics. Why do states around the world feel the need to do this? Is it because they are concerned about statistical rigor, or are they more concerned about justifying their lockdown regimes?" The ONS reported all-cause mortality for week 14 ending April 3rd. They recorded 16,387 deaths, which was 6,082 higher than the ONS 5-year average. They stated that 21.2% of total deaths mentioned COVID-19. The MSM immediately pounced on this, claiming this meant COVID-19 had pushed up the death toll to unprecedented levels. This was outrageous disinformation. That is not what the data showed. The ONS stated that of the 6,082 excess deaths, 3,475 mentioned coronavirus. Of those, 1,466 also mentioned influenza and pneumonia. Consequently, while registered deaths are 6,082 above the 5-year average, only 2,009 of those solely mentioned COVID-19, with 4,073 mentioning other underlying causes. It is worth remembering only COVID-19 deaths can be mentioned without a clear positive test result. Therefore, at least 67% of that excess mortality is being caused by other unknown factors that no one seems to care about. The MSM have absolutely no interests at all in this more severe health crisis. Why not? Once again, they have completely misled the public and deny the existence of another, more significant reason for concern. Perhaps anticipating this, the ONS stated, "Influenza and pneumonia has been included for comparison, as a well-understood cause of death involving respiratory infection that is likely to have somewhat similar risk factors to COVID-19. Short of openly stating that COVID-19 is no more deadly than any other pneumonia-like illnesses, the ONS appear to be trying to get a message across. Perhaps they can't say it directly. As the so-called pandemic has progressed, more in-depth studies have begun to emerge. Initial findings from Chinese scientists indicate that SARS-CoV-2 has an infection fatality rate of between 0.04% and 0.12%. which is comparable to flu pandemics with an estimated IFR of 0.1%. None of these have required a lockdown regime. Further studies have highlighted the overestimated risk allegedly presented by SARS-CoV-2, including a new study released just yesterday mentioning COVID-19 and deaths mentioning pneumonia and influenza. Influenza and pneumonia has been included for comparison, as a well-understood cause of death involving respiratory infection that is likely to have somewhat similar risk factors to COVID-19. Short of openly stating that COVID-19 is no more deadly than any other pneumonia-like illnesses, the ONS appear to be trying to get a message across. Perhaps they can't say it directly. As the so-called pandemic has progressed, more in-depth studies have begun to emerge. Initial findings from Chinese scientists indicate that SARS-CoV-2 has an infection fatality rate of between 0.04% and 0.12%, which is comparable to flu pandemics with an estimated IFR of 0.1%. None of these have required a lockdown regime. Further studies have highlighted the overestimated risk allegedly presented by SARS-CoV-2, including a new study released just yesterday. For the year to date, the ONS showed a comparison of the deaths mentioning COVID-19 and deaths mentioning pneumonia and influenza. Deaths this year from pneumonia and influenza appear to stand at around 30,000. Quite clearly, according to the ONS, other respiratory infections, like pneumonia and influenza, currently pose a significantly greater threat to life than COVID-19. Something is certainly pushing up mortality in the UK, but, at the very most, only 33% of that increase is vaguely attributable to COVID-19. Lockdown to cover a myriad of sins. The MSM have recently started floating the idea that the lockdown regime could become the new normal. According to the state, it may be necessary to go in and out of various levels of the regime from time to time, depending on the state's threat assessment. This is based on scientific research bought and paid for by pharmaceutical corporations and private foundations, including GlaxoSmithKline. Seeing as it is increasingly evident that the COVID-19 threat has been massively overhyped, why would the state and its globalist partners want the economic destruction to continue? Firstly, it delivers on a number of long-held globalist objectives. A cashless society, mandatory vaccination, universal basic income, a surveillance state, restricted freedom of movement, and a complete restructuring of the global economy have already been touted as necessary following the pandemic. All of these ambitions and economic realities existed before the pandemic first emerged in China. The state has already moved towards censoring anyone who questions vaccines. It is vital to understand that the canard of the anti-vaxxer is a meaningless trope. It is entirely possible to accept that vaccines can contribute towards effective preventative public health programs while, at the same time, questioning the efficacy and purpose of some vaccines. Vaccines are not all the same. The states and the MSM's insistence that anyone who question any vaccines is some sort of whacked-out, new-age, science Luddite is total nonsense. No one will be permitted to question vaccines, and that fact alone should be sufficient to raise anyone's suspicion. From Gavi to the WHO and from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to Imperial College, the response to the COVID-19 pandemic has been driven by foundations and pharmaceutical corporations with considerable investments in vaccine development. Of course, they would like to see global mandatory vaccination. To just ignore this, because you've been told by the MSM that questioning any vaccine is a conspiracy theory, not only evidences a lack of critical thinking, it demonstrates a degree of brainwashing. Global financial institutions, such as the IMF, have been advocating the cashless society for years. A cashless society will allow central banks to control every aspect of your life. Everything you buy can be tracked, and your purchases could easily be limited to exclude certain items. Although there is very little evidence that handling cash presents any increased threat of infection, that hasn't stopped the MSM from selling the idea. The impact of the lockdown regime across the globe has already had a devastating economic impact. All the indicators are that the regime will throw the global economy into a deep depression. The longer it continues, the worse it will get. The tendency of some to claim this doesn't matter because saving life is the only concern is hopelessly myopic. The link between poverty and significantly increased mortality is beyond dispute. The cure will definitely be far worse than the disease. As millions are forced into unemployment, the outlook isn't good. However, while the state will undoubtedly claim that unemployment has been caused by the COVID-19 crisis, in truth the imminent economic collapse was already driving up unemployment before the crisis began. This has led to increasing calls for the state to provide a universal basic income. This will create mass dependency upon the state for huge swathes of the population, affording the state immeasurable control over people's lives. In a cashless society, people who don't behave in accordance with state regulations could be punished financially. Instant fines will be commonplace. We are already seeing how that control can be deployed within a surveillance society as the state and its compliant MSM put the idea of immunity passports into the public imagination. The link between this and mandatory vaccination is obvious. This proposed policy comes straight from the heart of the globalist think tanks. ID 2020 is a globalist initiative which intends to provide everyone on Earth with an authorized identity. Gavi, Microsoft, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the Rockefeller Foundation are among the Happy ID 2020 Alliance who will decide who you are allowed to be. Comically, they claim that proving who you are to the state is somehow a human right. This is utter bilge. I don't know about you, but I know who I am, and so do the people I care about. I couldn't care less who the state thinks I am. Like everyone else on Earth, you were born with inalienable human rights. The state doesn't define what they are, they just choose to ignore them. ID 2020 is in no way objective. Your digital biometric ID can be good, which means it can also be bad. Bill Gates and Rockefellers are among those who state, with a good digital identity, you can enjoy your rights to privacy, security, and choice. Which means you can't if it's bad. As long as you are a good citizen, do as you are told, get your mandatory vaccinations and don't step out of line, you can have your rights, because megalomaniacs think they are gods who have the power to allow or deny them. Your digital ID will control the information you are allowed to access, and your immunity passport will almost certainly be part of your state-authorized identity as we move towards something indistinguishable from China's social credit system. It will be used to monitor your behavior. Your immunity passport status will depend upon where you go and who with. the state has decided that we all need contact tracing apps to regulate who we meet and limit our freedom of movement. If you meet the wrong person or go to the wrong area, or perhaps fail to produce your authorization Q code on demand, then you will be locked down. Perhaps the biggest deception of all is yet to come as the state maneuvers to blame the COVID-19 for the economic collapse. Firstly, it isn't COVID-19 but rather the lockdown regime that has sped up destruction of the economy, but that destruction was inevitable anyway. The 2008 credit crunch was a failure of the banks. They speculated in the markets and lost. As a result, we have endured a decade of austerity to bail them out. Socialism only applies to those who can afford it. Austerity has reduced essential public services to rubble, and now, when we supposedly need them most, we've all been placed under house arrest to stop us using them while many of the most vulnerable have been ignored. The irony is laughable. While we've all suffered austerity, the central banks have been printing funny money, blowing up the debt bubble to unimaginable proportions. The result has been increasing consumer debt, staggering levels of corporate borrowing and, though government deficits have reduced, government debt is off the charts, even in comparison to 2010 levels. This kind of debt-based economy was never sustainable and global financiers have known it for years. What the globalists needed was a reason to reset the economy without losing power. Perhaps it is another coincidence that the COVID-19 lockdown regime just happens to deliver both the mechanism and the excuse to press that global reset button. That it also ushers in all the globalists' desires is just another in a very long line of remarkable coincidences. Now that global terrorism is no longer a daily threat and global warming has been put on the back burner, the new normal of the ever-shifting threat from pandemic seems to be the novel war on terror. Training, funding and equipping terrorist groups has served the state well in the first two decades of the 21st century, but now it is ready to move on to the next phase by exploiting a terror closer to the heart of every home. Disease. In their totality, for those willing to look, it is transparent that these response measures have coalesced to create the framework for a totalitarian dictatorship. One rolling out at pace in the UK. Similar draconian diktats have sprung up across the globe. A coordinated global effort like this doesn't just happen. It takes years of training and planning. The only people who can't see it are those who, for whatever reason, choose not to. You have given your freedom away. Don't abandon critical thinking too. Coronavirus has supposedly forced the UK state to enact medical martial law. On the 23rd of March, Prime Minister Boris Johnson addressed the nation and outlined the measures to be enforced. The vast majority believe these are as follows. People will only be allowed to leave their home for the following very limited purposes. Shopping for basic necessities, as infrequently as possible. One form of exercise a day, for example a run, walk, or cycle, alone or with members of your household. Any medical need, to provide care or to help a vulnerable person. And travelling to and from work, but only where this is absolutely necessary and cannot be done from home. Yet how many of us are aware of the other liberties and individual protections we have just given away? For this, we need to look at the Coronavirus Act. The Coronavirus Act nightmare. 1. Laws governing determination of cause of death have been significantly relaxed. Even a funeral director can register a death. Registration documents can be electronic with no paper trail, chain of custody. Only one, instead of two confirmatory medical certifications are required. Juries won't decide inquests into alleged COVID-19 deaths. The state can cremate bodies regardless of family wishes and can seize control of corpse disposal. The NHS have indemnity for all medical negligence related to the treatment of coronavirus. 2. The 1983 Mental Health Act has been modified. You can be sectioned on the recommendation of a solitary registered medical practitioner, removing the previous safeguard requiring at least two independent medical opinions. 3. The NHS duty to assess continuing healthcare for claimed COVID-19 patients has been removed, as has the NHS duty to abide by the national framework. 4. The state takes the power to modify the Investigatory Powers Act using statutory instruments. The 2016 Investigatory Powers Act enabled the state to bring together investigative and intelligence gathering powers, the so-called Snoopers Charter. This act now extends surveillance warrants from 3 to 12 days duration and allows them to be signed by the Secretary of State's newly appointed temporary judicial commissioners. 5. The state can retain DNA and fingerprint profiles for an additional 6 months. 6. The state has seized the power to suspend all port activity and can request information from anyone in the food supply chain, including anyone who grows or produces their own food, to decide if they are disrupting the food supply chain. 7. The state gives itself the power to detain anyone who the state or its officers suspect may be infected with coronavirus. No medical assessment is required for the immediate power of detention to be exercised. The suspect may then be forced to undergo invasive medical procedures. 8. With the sole exception of the parliamentary estate, all gatherings of human beings in any location, including vehicles, are banned for a duration to be determined by the state. The offense of illegal gathering will result in a summary conviction and fine. 9. State powers pursuant to the 2003 Criminal Justice Act are enhanced. There's an increased use of evidence via live audio or video link. Judges may hear all evidence by audio or video link. However, jurors must attend court in person. Preliminary, incidental and bail hearings can be conducted solely as live audio hearings. 10. Democracy has been suspended and elections cancelled. The coronavirus bill in summary. The UK state has extended its ability to carry out surveillance on us all, increased its powers to detain people without trial, increased powers to section people and reduced safeguards, reduced healthcare protections, removed our ability to socialise and protest, reduced legal safeguards for accurately determining cause of death, taken control of the burial and coronal processes, reduced the required standard of evidence in the courts and suspended representative democracy. This act does far more than simply compel us to self-isolate and maintain social distancing. It is an enabling act. If you are reading this in the UK, you do not live in a democracy. Currently, it is set to expire 2 years from the date of royal assent unless Parliament votes in 6 months to rescind it. There is a distinct possibility that Parliament won't be sitting in 6 months, and even if it does, there is no guarantee they will decide to annul the legislation. Provision within the proposed act automatically allows for a further 6 months, meaning at least 2.5 years living under this form of state rule. Any future crisis might convince the state to maintain it beyond even that. Get used to it, in other words. Coupled with the immense economic impact of the state's response to coronavirus, it is reasonable to consider if the cure is not, in fact, considerably worse than the disease. It seems millions in the gig economy, those on zero-hour contracts and hundreds of thousands of SMEs will go to the wall. Many will undoubtedly be pushed into severe poverty, and with potential food shortages looming, the social and health harms caused by the government's response may well outweigh the harms of coronavirus by some margin. As the Bank of England cuts interest rates to 0.1% and purchases £645 billion of government bonds, effectively buying shares in the UK's productive economy, the UK central bank is hoovering up UK assets like they are going out of fashion. When the Chancellor announced a £330 billion underwriting package for the banks, to lend at interest to SMEs, he used public money to remove 80% of the risk from them and placed it squarely on the taxpayer, leaving the banks free to lend at handsome profit to collapsing UK businesses. However, the banks will pick what they call any viable business with turnovers of up to £45 million, all of whom will need to guarantee the remaining 20% of the loan. Smaller SMEs, with lower turnovers and cash flows, may well be unable to find the capital to meet the loan requirements. Even for better-off SMEs, the longer the economic shutdown continues, those who take up the offer will be at increasing risk of losing assets to the high street lenders. Giving them an opportunity to seize a chunk of the productive economy with virtually no risk at all. As all of this, including the Bank of England's creation of funny money, is funded by the taxpayer, it represents a huge transfer of wealth and assets from the working people of the UK to the central banks and high street lenders. Perhaps it's just a coincidence that this is a response to the coronavirus pandemic replicated across the Western world. Coronavirus scientific and statistical reasons for skepticism. At a time when we are being told to unquestioningly accept that we are at war with an invisible enemy, we need to use our critical thinking skills more than ever. On the 19th of March, Public Health England downgraded the alert level for COVID-19. The Advisory Committee on Dangerous Pathogens also judged that it was not sufficiently dangerous to warrant classification as a high-consequence infectious disease. Their assessment states, "Now that more is known about COVID-19, the public health bodies in the UK have reviewed the most up-to-date information about COVID-19 against the UK HCID criteria. They have determined that several features have now changed. In particular, more information is available about mortality rates, low overall, and there is now greater clinical awareness and a specific and sensitive laboratory test, the availability of which continues to increase. Ignoring this completely, the state passed the 2020 Coronavirus Act anyway. Public Health England maintain an all-cause mortality surveillance system to monitor deaths and judge alert levels. While the MSM has been pumping out fear porn, Public Health England have noted the comparative death rate. The Z level is the average based upon previous year statistics. For the week 12 period ending the 26th of March 2020 it states, no statistically significant excess mortality by week of death above the upper 2Z score threshold was seen overall, by age group or sub-nationally, all ages. Bluntly, there is no current evidence that COVID-19 deaths are statistically significant. However, the state's science-led response appears to have ignored these statistics in favour of far more alarming ones published by researchers at Imperial College London. Their research is based upon computer models stuffed full of questionable assumptions and predicts statistics that don't actually exist. If nothing is done, the researchers claim millions of deaths are inevitable. The Imperial Research Team, led by Professor Neil Ferguson, are part of the Imperial College's COVID-19 response team and have just launched the fundraising campaign as they race to develop a very expensive vaccine to keep us safe. Though, as yet, they have committed nothing to researching existing potential treatments to keep us safe. Imperial College just assumed SARS-CoV-2 incidence rates. These assumptions seem inexplicable because there's plenty of research on COVID-19 virulence. A nearly perfect case study of COVID-19 transmission rates already exists. 3,711 crew and passengers were quarantined together for nearly a month following an outbreak on the Diamond Princess cruise liner. Notorious for their susceptibility to infectious diseases, the ship presented an opportunity to study how infectious SARS-CoV-2 is. The study showed that 19% of the 3,711 people on board tested positive for coronavirus. Which means 81% didn't become infected on a ship where the average age of those quarantined was 58. This seemingly low transmission rate was also found in a study undertaken by the World Health Organization during the outbreak in China. They estimated between a 1-5% chance of infection in the community and noted the vast majority of transmission took place following prolonged exposures in confined spaces. Further research appeared to confirm that COVID-19 is not as virulent as seasonal flu. The serial interval for COVID-19 virus is estimated to be 5 to 6 days, while for influenza virus, the serial interval is 3 days. This means that influenza can spread faster than COVID-19. While we are learning that there are people who can shed COVID-19 virus 24 to 48 hours prior to symptom onset, at present, this does not appear to be a major driver of transmission. In the United States, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention estimates between 39,000 to 710,000 hospitalizations, and 23,000 to 59,000 deaths from influenza this year. Currently, there are 51,914 cases and 673 deaths from coronavirus in the U.S. Not only does it appear to be less virulent than influenza, in terms of mortality it isn't in the same league. Nor is there any reason to imagine it ever will be. Apparently none of this hard data had any effect on Imperial College's computer models. While research indicates a transmission rate of no more than 20%, predominantly among people living in crowded conditions during lengthy exposure periods, the modeling experts at Imperial College were sufficiently convinced by their own assumptions to state, we predict 81% of the GB and US populations would be infected over the course of the epidemic. This is 21% higher than the universally believed theory of 60% herd immunity, which national vaccination programs are all based upon, at which point viruses supposedly die off without enough hosts to infect. Accepting Imperial College's projected mythical reality without question, while ignoring the available empirical data, the UK state has delivered its medical martial law response. They say this is science-led, but it isn't. What are the coronavirus mortality statistics? As the MSM reports every death supposedly from COVID-19, they are not reporting any of the other excess deaths we might normally expect in the UK. According to the Office of National Statistics, with 540,000 deaths annually, there were only 23,200 excess winter deaths in England and Wales during the December 2018 to March 2019 period. This was a reduction on previous years and a very conservative estimate of around 25,000 excess winter deaths per year in England and Wales is reasonable. The UK government's chief scientific advisor Sir Patrick Vallance stated that he hoped the state's response could keep the deaths from coronavirus down to below 20,000. If they do reach such numbers, we should expect the additional deaths from the new terrifying coronavirus to raise the excess winter deaths rate to 45,000 at an absolute minimum. An excess winter deaths rate of more than 45,000 has recently been recorded in excess winter deaths periods commencing in 1978, 1984, 1985, 1996, 1998, 1999, and 2017. An excess winter deaths figure below 45,000 would indicate that coronavirus has made no remarkable impact at all. Many of these excess winter deaths will result from influenza and other infectious diseases. At the same time, clearly identifying COVID-19 has proven problematic. Nearly half of tests for COVID-19 in asymptomatic people probably produced false positive results in China, making calculations of overall SARS-CoV-2 infection and relative death rates difficult. Dividing the population into two groups, the healthy with coronavirus, and those with at least one additional underlying life-threatening condition, the statistician David Spiegelhalter explained this problem. There will be substantial overlap in these two groups. Many people who die of COVID would have died anyway within a short period, so these risks cannot be simply added. And it does not simply double the risk of people who get infected. There may end up being a minimal impact on overall mortality for 2020, although background mortality could increase due to pressures on the health services and the side effects of isolation. As Sir Patrick Vallance stated, we currently have no idea what this overlap might be. Given that it is also likely people with serious underlying illnesses will face an increasing risk of dying as a direct consequence of chronically overcrowded hospitals, reduced availability of emergency responders, social isolation, fuel and food poverty and other effects of the state's emergency response, calculating the excess winter deaths rate for the 2019-2020 period will be even more complex. This is further obscured because, in the vast majority of cases, there is no post-mortem examination of the deceased. Death is believed to be due to COVID-19. Despite no exact cause of death, it is recorded as a coronavirus death on the statistics we are now all sadly familiar with. The same is true in every other nation with similar systems, like Italy and the US, where postmortems identifying cause of death are exceptionally rare. Statistics from the outbreak in Italy show that the median age of death for men was 79 and for women 83. Of those who died, 98.8% had at least one serious underlying health concern, 75.2% had at least two, and 48.6% at least three. The Istituto Superiore di Sanità, ISS, Italian Institute of Health, recorded these deaths as COVID-19 deaths based upon the decision of a working group tasked with collating the electronic death cards from local doctors who diagnosed the patients with COVID-19. In short, there is no evidence these patients died from COVID-19. Currently, though uncomfortable to acknowledge, with 6,654 confirmed cases and 335 apparent deaths from COVID-19 in the UK, the scale of the risk is notable but also comparable to many others the nation has experienced in the past. Most recently in 2017. There is no evidence, from any nation, that excess winter deaths are currently above the normal Z average. What we have instead are scary stories which appear to be designed to convince us of the scale of the threat. We should ask why we need to be convinced. From a statistical perspective, evidence that SARS-CoV-2 itself is having any remarkable impact is non-existent. Many leading scientists remain entirely unconvinced, and the science does not demonstrate that SARS-CoV-2 threat in any way warrants global economic shutdown and all the human suffering it will bring. What is evident is a febrile atmosphere, created by the MSM and the state, which is causing mounting public and medical alarm. This is creating considerable additional workload and spikes in patient presentation numbers, while the supporting infrastructure evaporates, overloading already stretched health services, further exacerbating the problems. We are apparently shutting down the economy, agreeing to martial law, causing systemic healthcare collapse and transferring the nation's wealth to the banks based upon little more than a belief founded upon next to nothing. You have already given your freedom away, don't abandon critical thinking too. How did we get here, and where is it going? The seven-step path from pandemic to totalitarianism. There are just seven steps from pandemic declaration to permanent totalitarianism, and many jurisdictions are about to start step five. As if it was planned in advance, billions of people around the globe are being forced step by rapid step into a radically different way of life, one that involves far less personal, physical and financial freedom and agency. Here is the template for rolling this out. Step 1. A new virus starts to spread around the world. The World Health Organization declares a pandemic. International agencies, public health officials, politicians, media and other influential voices fan fear by focusing almost exclusively on the contagiousness of the virus and the rising numbers of cases, and by characterizing the virus as extremely dangerous. Within a few days, governments at national and local levels also declare states of emergency. At lightning speed, they impose lockdown measures that confine most people to their homes, starting with closing schools, and shut down much of the global economy. World markets implode. The stunned, fearful, and credulous public, convinced over the previous few years that their bodies do not have the natural ability to react to pathogens by producing antibodies that confer long-lasting immunity, largely complies willingly. The first weekly virtual class on local emergency and crisis responses to COVID-19 is held for mayors and other city officials around the world. Coordinated by a handful of American organizations in the academic, medical, financial, political, and transportation spheres, the classes feature guests ranging from Barack Obama to Bill Gates. Step 2. National, state, provincial, and municipal leaders, as well as public health officials, start daily press briefings. They use them to pump out frightening statistics and modeling asserting the virus has the potential to kill many millions. Most of this information is hard to decipher and sheds little real light on the natural course of the virus's spread through each geographic area. Officials and media downplay or distort inconveniently low death tolls from the virus and instead focus on alarming statistics produced by compliant academics, social media influencers, and high-profile organizations. The main message is that this is a war and many lives are at stake unless virtually everybody stays at home. Mainstream media amplify the trope that the world is at the mercy of the virus. Simultaneously, central banks and governments hand out massive amounts of cash largely to benefit the big banks. And they bring in giant private sector financial firms to manage the process despite these global companies' very poor track record in the 2008-2009 crash. Governments also rapidly start to create trillions of pounds worth of programs that include compensating businesses and workers for their shutdown-related losses. Step 3. There is a concerted effort by all levels of government and public health to very rapidly ramp up testing for viral RNA, along with production of personal protective equipment. They push aside the need for regulation, including quality standards and independent verification of tests' rates of accuracy, by insisting that fast approval and rollout are imperative for saving lives. Models are released that predict snowballing of numbers of cases, hospitalizations and deaths even under best-case scenarios. At about the same time, public health officials significantly loosen the criteria for viral infections, outbreaks and deaths, particularly in the oldest members of society. That increases the numbers of cases and deaths ascribed to the new pathogen. The media continue to clamor for more testing and for severe punishment of people who aren't completely compliant with the lockdown measures. As a result, there's little backlash as police and military with sweeping new powers enforce these measures and give stiff penalties or even jail terms to those who disobey orders. States also monitor with impunity massive numbers of people's movements via their cell phones. Vast human resources are focused on tracking down people who have had contact with a virus-positive individual and confining them to their homes. Thus, the portion of the public exposed to the virus remains relatively small. It also contributes to social isolation. Among many effects, this enables those in control to even further erase individual and collective choices, voices and power. Step 4. When the numbers of cases and deaths start to plateau, local officials claim it's too early to tell whether the virus has finished passing through the population and therefore, restrictive measures must continue. An alternative narrative is that if such measures aren't kept in place, there will be a resurgence of cases and deaths. Yet another is that the continuing climb in elderly persons' deaths means all bets are off for the time being. They admit that initial models incorrectly predicted there would be a tsunami of cases, ICU admissions and deaths. However, they assert more time is needed before it can be determined whether it's safe to loosen some of the restrictions and let children return to school or adults go back to work. Officials do not try to calculate the overall skyrocketing cost to the populations and economies of the shutdowns and other measures against, nor do they discuss what cost level may be too high. They and powerful media organizations also push for the massive virus testing overcapacity to be used to survey the general population for viral RNA in their bodies. At the same time, the rollout begins of widespread blood testing for antibodies to the virus. Meanwhile, new data are published showing the virus has a high capacity to mutate. Scientists and officials interpret this as meaning a larger medical arsenal will be needed to combat it. Step 5. About 2 or 3 weeks later, the dramatic increase in testing for viral RNA produces the desired goal of a significant upsurge in the number of people found positive for the virus. Public health officials add jet fuel to the surge by adding to the case and death tallies the large number of people who are only suspected, and not lab test confirmed, to have had an infection. Politicians and public health officials tell the populace this means they cannot return to their jobs or other activities outside the home for the time being. Governments work with public health agencies, academics, industry, the World Health Organization and other organizations to start to design and implement immunity passport systems for using the results of the widespread antibody testing to determine who can be released from the lockdowns. This is one of many goals of the seven steps. Meanwhile, government leaders continue to highlight the importance of vaccines for besting the virus. Step 6. Large-scale human testing of many different types of antivirals and vaccines begins, thanks to a concerted push from the World Health Organization, Bill Gates and his collaborators, pharmaceutical and biotech companies, governments and universities. Large swaths of the population don't have the antibodies to the virus because they've been kept from being exposed to it. They eagerly accept these medications even though they've been rushed to market with inadequate safety testing. They believe these medical products offer the only hope for escaping the virus's clutches. Step 7. Soon the new virus starts another cycle around the globe, just as influenza and other viruses have every year for millennia. Officials again fan the flames of fear by positing the potential for millions of deaths among people not yet protected from the virus. They rapidly roll out virus and antibody testing again, while companies sell billions more doses of antivirals and booster vaccines. Governments simultaneously cede control of all remaining public assets to global companies. This is because local and national governments' tax bases were decimated during Step 1 and they're virtually bankrupt from their unprecedented spending in the war against the virus in the other steps. The overall result is complete medicalization of the response to the virus, which on a population level is no more harmful than influenza. This is coupled with the creation of permanent totalitarianism controlled by global companies and a 24/7 invasive surveillance police state supported by widespread blossoming of smart technology. The key players repeat the cycle of hysteria and massive administration of antivirals and booster shots every few months. And they implement a variation of steps 1 to 7 when another new pathogen appears on the planet. And there you have it. The masses have unwittingly sold themselves into slavery due to their inability to think and question what they are told. Now they shelter in place, social distance, clap for care, and wait for the man on the telly to tell them it will all be over soon. Like sheep, they believe what they are told. Like sheep, they follow the crowd, and like sheep, they are inevitably led to slaughter. Why Sweden has already won the debate on the COVID lockdown policy. As Europe and North America continue suffering the steady economic and social decline as a direct result of imposing lockdown on their populations, other countries have taken a different approach to dealing with the coronavirus threat. You wouldn't know it by listening to Western politicians or mainstream media stenographers, but there are also non-lockdown countries. They are led by Sweden, Iceland, Belarus, Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan. Surprisingly to some, their results have been as good or better than the lockdown countries, but without having to endure the socio-economic chaos we are now witnessing across the world. For this reason alone, Sweden and others like them have already won the policy debate, as well as the scientific one too. Unlike much of the rest of the world who saw fit to unquestioningly follow China's lead on everything from quarantining to economic shutdowns to contact tracing and PCR mass testing, non-lockdown countries have instead opted for a somewhat lighter touch, preserving their economies and societies, and in doing so avoiding an endless daisy chain of new problems and obstacles deriving directly from the imposition of brutal lockdown policy. On the European front, the Scandinavian country of Sweden is now garnering more attention than before, and has become an object of both criticism and fascination for those against or in favor of lockdown policy. While countries like the United States and Great Britain continue to top the global tables in terms of COVID-19 death tolls, Sweden has only suffered marginal casualties in comparison, while avoiding the intense strain on society and loss in public confidence which lockdown governments are now grappling with as they continue to push their populations to the limits of social stress and economic tolerance. You could say those governments are already careening over the edge by looking at the latest jobless figures coming out the US with 30 million new people filing for unemployment in the last few weeks. Unlike many others, Sweden has not enforced any strict mass quarantine measures to contain COVID-19. Nor has it closed any of its borders. Rather, Swedish health authorities have issued a series of guidelines for social distancing and other common sense measures covering areas like hygiene, travel, public gatherings, and protecting the elderly and immune compromised. They have kept all preschools, primary and secondary schools open, while closing college and universities who are now doing their work and lectures online. Likewise, many bars and restaurants have remained open, and shoppers do not have to perform the bizarre ritual of queuing around the block standing 2 meters apart in order to buy groceries. According to the country's top scientists, they are now well underway to achieving natural herd immunity. It seems this particular Nordic model has already won the debate. Because Sweden decided to follow real epidemiological science and pursue a common-sense strategy of herd immunity, it doesn't need to flatten of the curve because its strategic approach has the added benefit of achieving a much more gradual and wider spread. Anders Tegnell, Sweden's government advisor for epidemiology, explains, "We're all trying to keep the spread of this disease as low as possible, mainly to prevent our healthcare system from being overstretched, but we have not gone for the complete lockdown. We have managed to keep the number of cases low enough so the intensive care units have kept working and there has always been 20% beds empty and enough protective equipment, even in Stockholm, where there has been a huge stress on healthcare. So in that way the strategy has worked. Similarly, it doesn't have to deal with the newest crisis obstacle which lockdown states seem to be using as an excuse not to reopen society and the economy, which the fear of a second peak which governments are telling the public will wreak havoc on the nation by infecting the vulnerable and will overwhelm the health services if everything is suddenly reopened and social isolation and distancing is relaxed. This catch-22 which countries like the US and UK are caught in is predicated on the belief that the coronavirus might suddenly unleash itself again on the populace. Certainly, there could be a second surge, but it should be noted that this is also a direct result of the decision to impose lockdown in the first place. According to top epidemiologist Dr. Knud Wikowski, the decision to lock down only delayed the inevitable for countries like the US and UK, and quite possibly made the COVID-19 problem even worse than it would have previously been in the short to mid-term, but in the long term the results would be relatively the same proportionally in terms of human casualties. The penny should have really dropped after it was revealed 2 weeks ago by Oxford professor Carl Heneghan, director for Centre for Evidence-Based Medicine, that the peak of the UK's coronavirus crisis actually came a full week before Boris Johnson initiated lockdown on March 23rd. In fact, if you plug in Sweden's actual data into Neil Ferguson's own infamous computer model which sent the UK government into mass panic mode, here's what you would get. The numbers don't lie, but statistics can be made to tell any story the narrator wants, especially when the storyteller is government. Just look at the last 50 years of announcements regarding unemployment and inflation levels. One thing we should have learned by now is that government will never let things like facts and real science get in the way of a slow-motion train wreck in progress, hence you can see some UK officials still clinging to Ferguson's initial prediction as some sort of proof that the lockdown was necessary to avoid mass death. Outside of popular supposition and media talking points, there is no scientific study which shows that lockdown saved any significant number of lives. Instead, new data strongly suggests quite the opposite. As Western lockdown countries drift further and further into an economic and social purgatory, non-lockdown countries like Sweden seem to be the target of bad-natured criticism by Western media punditry. This seems to be out of spite more than anything, as some journalists are sensing defeat after they had thrown their lot in with draconian lockdown policy early on, unquestioningly backing their government's one-size-fits-all approach to emergency management, once again invoking the TINA, there is no alternative principle which history shows often precedes most man-made calamities from World War I, the Iraq War in 2003, to the 2008 Wall Street bailout. Nonetheless, the media and political pressure has been almost relentless on Sweden for not complying with the West's lockdown consensus. The country has also been roundly criticized by some 2,300 academics who piled on scorn upon it in a letter posted in March demanding the government change course and immediately head for lockdown. However, the country has held off, and has since won endorsements from a number of eminent academics and professionals, like Professor Hinahan, who hailed Sweden for holding its nerve in the face of such public condemnation. That steadfastness seems to finally be paying dividends now, as some Western mainstream media outlets, and even the UN itself, are acknowledging their comparable success. The New York Post begrudgingly acknowledged that Sweden received praise from the High Chair of Global Public Health at the World Health Organization, now lauded it as a model for overcoming the coronavirus crisis. Dr. Michael Ryan, World Health Organization head of emergency management, said, "What it has done differently is it has very much relied on its relationship with its citizenry and the ability and willingness of its citizens to implement self-distancing and self-regulate." He added, "In that sense, they have implemented public policy through that partnership with the population. I think if we are to reach a new normal, Sweden represents a model if we wish to get back to a society in which we don't have lockdowns." So according to World Health Organization, it is Sweden which could be the new normal, and not the reactionary medieval quarantine policies favored by other states. Is the World Health Organization really making an argument against obsessive social isolation and collective economic suicide? Such words from the World Health Organization should, in theory, be reassuring to those stuck in their lockdown death spirals. But many in the West are still convinced of the TINA principle, even if the next-door neighbor has chosen a short and more practical route through the eye of the storm. More than anything, this conundrum speaks to the relationship between people and their governments. Indeed, it is the social contract between government and its citizens which forms the core of the country's policy formation. The idea that the choice of lockdown policy is a straight trade-off between lives and economy is a false dichotomy which ignores many concomitant variables and factors which are at play. I don't think it was in terms of economy versus a health of people. I think it was a broader concern about the social fabric in general," said Lars Traegard, professor of history and civil society studies at Ørsta Sköndal University College. Professor Cecilia Söderberg Naukla from Sweden's Karolinska Institute explained why the state was duty-bound to take the direction it did. "We must establish control over the situation. We cannot head into a situation where we get complete chaos. No one has tried this route, so why should we test it first in Sweden without informed consent?" said Söderberg Naukla. This concept of people taking responsibility for their actions and for public well-being is actually enshrined in Sweden's constitution. This means that the state does not have to threaten and abuse its citizens for things like not observing social distancing and buying non-essential items when out shopping or meeting in small groups, as some governments are doing. Swedes know the risks and observe government guidelines accordingly. They also acknowledge that humans are not perfect and won't use police and courts to punish citizens if they are not following guidelines to the letter, as is the case in many lockdown countries. In lockdown countries, the bad blood between the public and government will not evaporate after the crisis is over, which is a real problem which lockdown governments will continue facing in the future. Still, New York Post had to include the caveat that Sweden was something of a pariah state for controversially refused restrictions. The propaganda war could be seen in the paper's subtle wordsmithing, where editors even went so far as to change their headline from, "The World Health Organization lauds Sweden as a model in coronavirus fight for resisting lockdown," to a slightly more incendiary, "World Health Organization lauds lockdown ignoring Sweden as a model for countries going forward." Swedish critics are quick to point out how poorly it's doing compared to its Scandinavian neighbors Denmark, Norway, and Finland. They do this by pointing to the new global bible of public policy, the Worldometer coronavirus running totals, which for some people is now the end-all and be-all which it comes to declaring how really bad things are, and will continue to be, because that meter just keeps on running. As of today, Sweden, which has a population of roughly 10.5 million, has recorded 21,092 cases and 2,586 fatalities from COVID-19, that's roughly 256 deaths per million people. By contrast, its southern neighbor Denmark, which has a population of 5.8 million, has recorded 91,058 cases and 452 fatalities, roughly 78 deaths per million persons. Norway has a similar population at 5.4 million, and has recorded 7,738 cases and 210 deaths, that's 39 deaths per million. Finland has a population of 5.5 million, confirmed just 4,995 cases and 211 deaths, with 38 deaths per million. Critics of Sweden have all seized upon these differences in order to condemn their government for being irresponsible and playing Russian roulette with their citizens' lives. If one didn't know better from all the hysterical rhetoric, you'd think there was an impending genocide happening there. While these sort of polemic arguments seem to work in the narrow band of reality that a social media threads, the reality is that after scaling up its neighbors' results to be in line with Sweden's larger population, which is roughly twice their size, the difference is statistically insignificant for a country of 10.5 million. They are basically arguing that when comparing Sweden to its neighbor Denmark, that a proportional difference of approximately 1,500 fatalities warrants Sweden closing all its schools and shutting down its entire economy and suffer all the chaos ill effects that goes with that course of action. To put things in even more perspective, while Sweden has already suffered 2,586 COVID deaths in 2020, back in 2018 there were approximately 6,997 total respiratory disease deaths in Sweden, and the country's healthcare capacity was not overrun. Nor were any of their public systems stretched to breaking point. It's a ridiculous argument on its face, and yet this is the line of thinking which seems to permeate through lockdown countries desperate to justify their own fatal policy decisions. It's not a discussion for faint hearts, but this has been a reality for nations since time immemorial who have faced war plagues and pandemics. There is no perfect answer, but there are practical answers that take utilitarianism into account. Fear of the second wave. In what can only be described as a macabre display of bad faith, exasperated naysayers from lockdown countries seem almost eager to see Sweden fall victim to the dreaded second wave, which many Britons and Americans insist is a fait accompli, as their political leaders and science experts keep telling them. The threat of a second wave is certainly being used by some governments to justify an increasingly unpopular lockdown policy, but also lends itself to the preferences of Bill Gates, who has been publicly advocating an open-ended lockdown arrangement until such a time that salvation will arrive in the form of a vaccine for the coronavirus. But even the most optimistic scenario would be somewhere between 18 months and 2 years, which begs the question of whether democracies and their economies can survive such an extended period of tumult. That's a scenario which no one can realistically endorse, and yet it's given prime time by mainstream media outlets who have been keen to offer up the Gates plan as another Tina solution to the pandemic. Besides the obvious civilizational problems with the Gates global lockup plan, it chronically ignores the fact that there are non-lockdown countries like Sweden who never opted into the West's collective self-destruction pact. Not everyone is on board with the inevitability of a second wave, which the American and British government keeps insisting is coming if lockdown is lifted too early. Renowned Scottish microbiologist Professor Hugh Pennington is not convinced, saying that such a second peak is unlikely. Still, Professor Pennington seemed miffed as to where Boris Johnson's government is getting its science from. "I know where it comes from flu. Because when we have a flu pandemic, we always get a second peak, and sometimes we get a third peak. Now, why we should get one with this virus, I don't quite understand. It just seems to be a phenomenon with flu, and I don't see any reason myself. I haven't seen any evidence to support the idea that there would be a second peak of the virus." According to other experts, one of the fundamental problems with lockdown policy favored by the US, UK, other European countries, is that it was never evidence-based or guided by the science. Quite the opposite, in fact. Rather, it was a political decision undertaken by politicians. Never in history has a country enacted such a universal measure which quarantines the healthy as well as the sick and infirmed. This also flies in the face of hundreds of years of epidemiological science and epidemic policy, and eschews the entire concept of natural herd immunity. Again, the pragmatic approach would have been to protect those most directly affected by COVID-19, which is overwhelmingly the elderly and those in palliative care, a policy which would eventually bring a population herd immunity as a natural byproduct of that policy. That's been the approach taken by Sweden and other states, and according to numerous experts in the field, it makes sense on both an epidemiological level and well as a social and economic level. In a recent interview with Radio 5, leading Swedish epidemiologist Dr. Johan Giesek remarked how the UK had initially proposed the same plan as Sweden, but then Boris Johnson came under intense pressure from the media and opposition after the arrival of Imperial College's notorious 50,000 dead paper presented to the government by Professor Neil Ferguson. As a result, UK officials quickly changed course in a 180-degree U-turn, said Giesek, who was shocked how an unpublished paper relying on computer models and with no peer review could have played such a crucial role in altering such an important policy decision. How did that happen? One only has to look at the obvious nexus of funding between the UK government, Imperial College and the Gates Foundation to get a possible answer to that question, which we will explore in greater detail in later chapters. The real question in all of this should be, who and what is driving Western government's disastrous lockdown policy? After reviewing the evidence, we can rule out one possibility: it's certainly not the science.